everyone to the June 2nd, 2015 meeting of the Board of Selectmen. I'll go over the agenda for tonight briefly. We will first have Selectmen's liaison reports and comments, followed by public comment, and followed by the town manager's report. We then have a number of discussion action items. We will be appointing town council at about 7:20, hearing a town accountant report on the recent audit report, and holding a hearing that's at 7:25, the town accountant. At 8 p.m., a hearing on a second driveway request at 137 to 139 Salem Street. At 8:15, we will have an open forum on the proposed and funded Birch Meadow Field lighting plan. We have noticed significant numbers of the abutters there. We hope to have a great discussion with the Recreation Committee. Then we will adjourn the regular session for executive session at 9:30 to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining. So, Jake, how are you?
I'm doing.
So with that, can we go to liaison reports? Start with John.
I just want to thank my colleagues for covering for Memorial Day duty. It's a somber event to go before our towns and, in a greater sense, our nation's war memorials and reflect on the sacrifice that literally millions have made before us to preserve the place we all call home and the future we all hope for our children. Thank you for all for doing that. And thank you for all the veterans for their service.
Barry?
Just picking up on that, I had the opportunity to give the selectmen's address at Laurel Hill, and I have to admit, it's the, I think it was the maybe first or only the second time I've actually even ventured into Laurel Hill, not having any family members there. And what's really striking about it when you get in there is just the amazing amount of flags. Obviously, being a newer cemetery, lots of the World War II and Korean War veterans and Vietnam veterans are buried there. So, and it was a different kind of a feel than at Laurel Hill, where you have basically the whole town and the whole band and a whole set of ceremonies. This is a much more streamlined, and the people who came out were predominantly relatives of folks who have family buried there. So, it was a lot quieter. A lot more subdued, but it was a very powerful kind of moment and something that I'll remember for a while. The last couple of weeks, I attended one of the Dr. Daugherty and the school committee hosted a series of meetings at the different schools, the elementary schools, the middle school, and the high school, to do an assessment, sort of what we're doing on the town side, kind of like, you know, what are we doing well? What do we need to do better? What do we want that we don't have now? What do we have that we can maybe live without? And they invited parents in the different schools to come. I attended one at Barrows for the elementary, and by and large, it was incredibly positive in the sense that people are really satisfied with the services that are happening and the way the schools are being run. Like everything else, there was a list of items that people wish they had. And you know, I would characterize some of those things not really as a want, but maybe as a need. For example, you know, more music in the elementary schools. You know, bringing the robotics piece down a couple of levels. You know, like more engineering, things like that. That you know, we don't have now. That they thought would be a good add. But by and large, people really satisfied the way the schools were done. Obviously, a few tweaks, things that they wanted to change, but. When I went in there, I was sort of expecting kind of, you know, a list of grouses, but it was really more support, which was really nice to see, you know, given that, you know, the schools like on the town side are struggling to do a lot with what they have, and people by and large supportive, but again, also wanted to push it and make it better. So that was actually a nice, that was nice to hear on the school side.
So. Thank you.
Yeah, I'd also like to comment in regards to the Memorial Day celebrations. I got to march in the parade with my daughter, which was very fun.
She
made it all the way. Yes, that long trek, it was great. So she saw a lot of friends. And I think her teacher as well on the sideline. It was nice to see. It was a well attended event, certainly. for the veterans in town and past. And it was certainly a pleasure to give a speech down at the Child's Lawn as well. So I thought it was a very nice day. I think Kevin Bowmiller should certainly be commended for putting on as a master of ceremonies. He did a great job from start to finish. Of course, Bill Brown, as being one of the members, along with Frank Driscoll, who was able to put out the flowers and the markers and flags, along with some of the other groups in town, the Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, Brownies, and some citizen volunteers. So it was really, I think, a nice community event. It's a really nice tradition to see, especially that piece of it in our community. It's I think it's something that certainly brings us together. So that was certainly an honor. This past Wednesday, also met with the Firearm Ad Hoc Committee, and this was our second meeting. It was attended by our town council as well as one of his staff members. If I could remember her name, I would say it right now. It's a very unusual one. Bob may know. I apologize. and I think that was a very productive meeting. So the sense of the meeting right now is basically looking at the charge from what town meeting had given us, which is to look at firearm safety in respect to section 8.9.1 of our town bylaws. And try to see what we could do, if anything, to have it make more sense for all citizens in town involved. And we have a really good committee in regards to that. We have some folks, I think, on that do not have agendas in the room, and it's nice. They certainly have their opinions. Most of them, if not all of them, certainly bring a level of skill and past history in regards to firearm safety, one side or the other. So it's actually a really good committee, and right now we're looking at and have tasked Ray with a couple of different options to try to say, maybe rewriting this is in general would be a good thing. Ray's noted that he's not crazy about some of the language, our town council that is, not crazy about some of the language, the way it's been referenced, and said it's a little bit messy the way it is right now. And so we kind of charged him with a little bit of taking a crack at, okay, if you were going to rewrite this, knowing that what you can and can't do in regards to state law, go ahead and see if you can do so. So we've given him a few options to try to come back to us with on this coming Monday night. We're going to be meeting at the police station at the upstairs conference room at 6:30. Paul, is it 6:30 that I had told you from the last one? I think it was 6 or 6:30. It'll be on the website. It'll be interesting to see what he comes back with. There's certain limitations, obviously, that we have as a group, and there's a lot of information out there, really, to whittle through. And, we're not the first town to come across this, so we're also kind of taking it from that perspective of, who's already been down this bridge and what has and hasn't flown with the Attorney General.
Kevin, it's a little early going, but as you look at the work ahead, do you have a sense what the overall schedule might be in terms of where you hope to end up? Is it sometime in the fall? Is it?
Yeah, I think what our goal right now, we're meeting every 2 weeks.
Yeah,
we're going to try to keep that up through the summer. Although we know folks may or may not be able to make it certain days and times, but we're going to try to keep up on an every 2 week schedule until we have something to report. That report might be, we feel this is the, rewriting this bylaw is the best thing to do, and here's what we've come up with. But we've, there's not, it could be as simple as there's not a whole lot that we want to do other than cleaning up the language of the bylaw that we have existing right now. Our goal definitely is to try to get back before this body presents something in late August, with the intention of that, if we need to go to town meeting before something, that we'd have the time in order to properly do it.
Good. Thank you. Thanks very much.
Okay, I too was very honored to give not one but two speeches on Memorial Day. I spoke at Laurel Hill and Wooded Cemeteries, and I most impressive thing I saw that they four World War II veterans who placed the wreath at Laurel Hill, and those gentlemen were still standing straight and proud and happy to be there, and I just felt my role was so small compared to what they've done for the country. Thank them personally. and that was a great event. Following that, I went over to the Troop 702 100th year anniversary down at Higgins Hall. Troop 702 is the 14th oldest Boy Scout troop in the nation now. We used to have about a dozen in town. We're down to really two active ones, 702 and 728. And there were a number of folks I recognized from the glorious days of yesteryear when I had three scouts going through that troop. And our distinguished, sometimes they consider themselves extinguished representatives are down there and presented some proclamations. So that was a great time for all. On Tuesday the 26th, Selectman Halsey and Berman joined me in a walk with Secretary Ash. What's his exact title, Bob? Secretary of
Housing Economic Development.
Housing Economic. We sat around in a conference room for a short time. The Secretary was extremely familiar with what Reading has done in terms of our 40R, our housing production plan, and he actually praised us for being very proactive. He said, you know, we have to drag some towns kicking and screaming where you folks are today. You've really made great strides. Gene shared a story about another town that actively resisted putting housing in their downtown. I won't mention any towns, protect the guilty. But he called us out for, you know, the 40R concept. And we also toured that area. We toured the potential 40B site at Prescott and Lincoln. And that raised his eyebrows a bit, I think. So maybe we'll get a little help there in kind of channeling that project into a more reasonable scale. But I thought it was a very successful visit. Anything you want to add, Bob, from that?
No, he's a real solid guy. He was the first major hire by the new governor, and he set a tone with that hire, of hiring, first of all, reaching across party lines, and picking just a really solid guy that everyone would tell you is a really solid guy.
Right.
So he works really well with everyone.
Terrific. That's my report.
One quick thing, sorry,
sure.
Before we go into,
right.
I just want to have a noted, Paula, that I forgot to mention, fellow board member John Halsey was is part of that ad hoc firearm safety committee, and he was with me there that night. So, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, moving on to public comment. Is there anyone here who wants to make a comment for anything not on the agenda? Thank you. And the town manager's report?
Kevin covered it, but I do want to emphasize thanks to both Frank Driscoll and Bill Brown for their help as always. And, you know, if you will, a special thanks to Kevin Bowmiller, who was only on the job for a couple of weeks to put that together. And from my vantage point on the sidelines, which I was happy to be on, I thought he did a really nice job.
Yeah. He did.
Yeah. And in terms of the 40B, where you just mentioned, we have no formal updates. We've communicated our part to both to the state. They owe us comments, and they owe the applicants the same comments, but I have nothing further to report. I do want to remind the board, June 13th, Friends and Family Day, we'll be having a table right next to the school committee yet again, so you can have the same pie-eating contest.
Wasn't there a dunk contest?
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that where the dunk tank's going to be as well, too, I heard?
That was a little further away.
Oh,
they had the wrong size hose last year. That's always tricky because it's either pouring rain or brutally hot.
Yeah.
Or squishy mud. Yeah.
Yeah, and there's not a lot of middle ground. But if you could let me know your availability, I've heard from Kevin. I don't know that I've heard from the rest of you yet.
I can be there for
I think you said
when
yeah.
you need me.
Yeah. Let me know. Generally, it's 11 to 3. There's no reason that any of you have to be there for 4 hours. I'll attempt to be there for the duration. Through the chair, I will describe some of the things we're going to bring.
Mm-hmm.
Things change over the years. I think at this point, it's appropriate to show the 40B sites to anyone who might come by. And Gene has a whole list of other visual aids going on. And so I'll run that past you, Dan.
How about some of the MAPC, the four development areas?
We were thinking about that. Yeah,
that's
one of them.
To put up.
Yeah, just to show kind of planning. There's certain projects that we receive a lot of comments on, Von Ratty's being one.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the typical three or four projects will have some kind of visual also and, you know, be able to tell what the updates are, what the stories are.
Good.
I think the rest is just in the packet. I'll skip it. But I do appreciate the fact that the three of you were able to take some time out of your day and join us last week for that walkthrough.
That was a pleasure.
That was great.
I'm sure that we all learned something that day. I, I still challenge him to be more critical of us, but maybe that'll be forthcoming.
I just think that it's great. First of all, I'm glad that it came out. I think that we shouldn't underestimate or take for granted the things that we do here, because, you know, the struggles that he has in other communities to kind of get them to kind of think the way we do.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I'm still trying to think, you know, a little out of the box about how we can kind of leverage, you know, if we can be the poster child for how to do things right, and then let him take us on the road so we get exposure, so people come, oh, Reading, I didn't know that. I mean, I think that could have some positive play.
Well, he knows us well enough. He knows Gene and I for 10 years. Yeah. He knows what we are and aren't good at, what we're capable of, and basically the thing he knows the most is we're all brutally honest, and we just don't mess around. I've worked with Jay when he was city manager on the vocational school issues, so we really had to dig in the weeds on that a few times and have some interesting discussions.
This is Everett?
He was Chelsea. So he knows what we are pretty well, and if he thinks the Baker administration will have some advantage, he will absolutely ask us. I have no doubt about that. And as I mentioned to him, you know, you want to beta test stuff.
That's right.
You know Reading. You know what we are and what we're not. We're not an urban center. But you know what we are.
We're not Burlington, but we're not Lexington.
Yeah. So he knows. But thanks for coming. But that's all I have.
Okay, Bob. Thank you. Okay, we can now move to, right on time, the appointment of town council. Bob, I think you made a very astute comment in your report to us. Bob is recommending, I don't think you need even do that to the board, a reappointment of Myers and Harrington. Bob said, in case you need my view, Myers and Harrington are the perfect legal fit for the town. Very significant legal progress has been made under their watchful eye over the past year, and we are better positioned for the future. I have no idea how we could have tackled the zoning bylaws and the charter issues without a team with not just the experience, but I think the heart to really get in and work hard and do this thing right and do it efficiently. So I'm very, are there any other comments before we have to proceed to a motion?
Well, for those of you that remember the interviews, again, for those on television, the selection of a town council is finding the right match. It's a little like finding your friends and maybe in a greater sense person you end up with, in the right temperament, the right understanding of what's going on. And what Ray and team have been able to do is use small tools when small tools are appropriate and bring the bigger tools to bear when it's appropriate. We met with some of the other potential candidates that I think thought about this much more in terms of blunt force approach,
yeah.
And Ray's really got a soft touch when a soft touch is needed. So, I think we should proceed. My intent is just to proceed to the vote.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I second to all of what everybody said. Having been on town meeting, you know, years before and seeing from a town person's perspective about how some of the former town councils would just talk at meetings, it sort of felt like, you know, sort of being talked at and like I should be smarter than I am. And, you know, Ray just, you know, sort of brings it down so that in digestible pieces so that everybody understands, and he's respectful of people's views, and I think it's great. Just one general question, and I'm going to support the motion, but I just want to put it out there. You know, I reviewed the budget that you had put in our packet, and I'm just curious, for a town like us, at what, given some of the complex legal issues that are kind of we've been dealing with and some that we can anticipate, at what point does it become sort of, you know, either fiscally prudent or just a smart idea to retain our own counsel? And this way we have someone on staff that we get 100% of the time, we can understand the budget. You know, obviously we'd have to put out for some of the maybe the more complicated things, but is there a critical mass of either work or complexity or cost that it might make sense for us to kind of take a step back and say, you know, let's have our own counsel?
We talked about that a number of times in the past. Part of it is a philosophical question, not a financial or a practical one. Melrose, for instance, has in-house counsel, and I'm assuming, I don't know this, that they supplement that as they need to. Wakefield has kind of a quasi-arrangement where it's someone that's
in Wakefield, lives in Wakefield, and is split, I think, with two towns, and I know they supplement. To our north and our west, they do what we do. Historically, Reading has been, I'll say, very tight with the money and legal expenses for whatever reason. Towns of our size where we were spending 60 to 100,000, they were regularly spending 300,000 to 400,000 every year. I don't know if that money was well spent or not, but it was always an interesting
maybe
difference.
Maybe more litigation.
Yeah, probably more litigation, knock on wood. I think the question is not so much what your budget is, but what are the common things you're always facing? Because when you're facing a wide variety of things, one person's not going to solve them all. You need a team. But if you're constantly facing zoning issues, and zoning is 3/4 of your legal budget every year, it may well make sense to hire a zoning expert as in-house counsel. In this first year, I tried to categorize it, and I send you guys an update. Right. It's all over the place.
It is.
This
yeah,
year.
It is.
We'll know better in another year. Yeah. We still have some zoning work to do. That will be complete, hopefully, next year. The charter's done, thank goodness. There's still some litigation. There may be some work on general bylaws. Some of it relates to you. Some of it is other things that have come up along the way where there may be some inconsistencies out there. So the second year might also be a little bit random, one-sided. And just the other piece of this, where we have some litigation still ongoing, most notably the high school litigation. I generally would prefer to have an employee, mm-hmm. but right now an employee would not have helped us, and I don't think would next year. But it's something to always keep in the back of your mind.
Interestingly, we actually do have part of an employee that can be used in, you know, for fairly minor things legally. That's
Matt
Cronellis.
Yeah, Matt is
was a
law degree.
We didn't have someone at the department level at the JD before, so. But it's
that's
a good thought.
Question. Yeah.
Good right. question.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Can we have a motion, please?
Move that the Board of Selectmen appoint the firm of Myaris and Harrington as town council.
That's seconded.
Second.
Further discussion. Hearing none. All in favor? Vote is 4-0. Congratulations. And your opinion, Bob, was that we need not put a time limit on this?
Ray had actually been surprised the first time when there was a time limit, since he said he could be fired at an instant's notice.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Got it.
And as a lawyer, he would suggest we not do it that way.
Well, can he fire us?
He could.
She could, yeah.
No, I mean, just like, you know, listen, I got a better deal in North Reading.
Employment at will.
It is. Yeah, he can anyways. You can appoint him for a year and he can still...
You can always fire your boss, Barry, you know that.
Yeah,
yeah, he has a really interesting policy that I've never heard of before, not dealing with contiguous towns. I think he's faced with a challenge right now with some possible business, not Reading, where that philosophy may be tested. But,
that's interesting.
If you remember, during the hiring process, they stood out to me anyways. But I thought the most interesting thing he said in his closing argument, if you will, why should we hire you? He mentioned three things. The third one was humor.
Yeah.
Yes.
You have to be a special person to use that as your opportunity to say three things about yourself. And I have to tell you, that approach has been most helpful in the last year. The relaxed, let's all catch our breath.
Relaxed, yet very hardworking. You'll get emails from the guy at midnight.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Not because he has to, but because he loves what he's doing.
Yep.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the time has come. Sharon, welcome. It's time for the town accountant report. And you'll be covering the Melanson Heath audit. Any other topics, or just pretty much that?
I'm going to give you kind of a brief overview of the finances as we're approaching your end, and then talk about. There was also something that rolls into the audit comments that had come up before we actually got the audit comments. So we'll go into that as well. I just want to start by saying welcome to Barry.
Oh, thank you.
I think I've presented since you've been a member of the board.
Thank you.
So the packet, the packet I have here is just kind of a summarized view of what I might look at each month to kind of determine if we have any issues that I want to drill deeper into, and this is kind of very summary. This first page here is all of our revenues summarized by some of kind of summarized categories. Make it easier for me. And what I do is I tend to look at that percentage used and determine if we've collected, this is the revenues, if we've collected what we projected, and where I'd expect us to be percentage-wise given where we are in the year. And if you look at the bottom, it says we're at 103% of projected revenues. And that's because under that other funding sources with the star next to it, that's where the bond proceeds are from our issuance, the piece that came back to us, whatever we borrowed for the projects, all the refunding got paid directly. So that kind of makes it look like we've collected everything. But really, we are in good shape at like 98% of projected budget. Okay. So that's really good.
That's good.
Are you saying that's return free cash that is now bonded, or is that some other cash flow?
The other funding sources is bond proceeds that are going to be used for projects.
Okay,
so they're actual bond transferred out to.
I think it was almost all the library.
Library,
yeah.
And.
Okay.
So then I just kind of take a look and see, geez, what percentages strike me as low? And other excise taxes seemed low, but when I looked at the detail, I realized that other excise taxes is our meals tax and is paid to us on a quarterly basis, and we haven't received the last quarter's payment. Looking at the first three quarters, we're averaging $86,000 to $92,000 each quarter, so if we're short $79,000, I feel pretty comfortable we're going to make budget there. So that's kind of some of what I do when I'm looking at this.
And we budgeted $350 for that next
year,
right?
Yeah.
Okay.
It has been something that's been trending a little lower lately, and I'm not sure why.
Just a quick question. This is something I don't know if you know off the top of your head or not. Sharon, does that typically get lower in the third quarter? That's something you recall as noticing?
There is definitely seasonality to it.
There definitely is. The third quarter was the lowest.
Third calendar year quarter, yes.
Yeah.
First fiscal.
Okay. Well, right. First fiscal, yeah.
But
and it's lagged a little too.
It does seem like even at the lowest point that we've seen it, I think it will still make budget on this line item. But
okay.
Even if we were short, there's overages in other areas that would protect us from having a revenue deficit or anything of that sort. Payment in lieu of tax, when I looked into that, that looks a little bit low percentage-wise. And the biggest component of payment in lieu of tax is the RMLD payment in lieu of tax. And they pay biannually. And so that last payment comes in at the end of June. And it's about $145,000, $146,000. And that definitely will cover what we have remaining to meet budget. So I think we're okay there as well.
Okay.
State revenues was another area that I drilled a little bit deeper and discovered that even though I ran this report as of June 1st, the May payments come in at the end of May, and our treasurer was on vacation, and they weren't there. So then that answered that question when I project out what we've got 10 payments because we get a monthly payment from the state. You know, two more payments, and we should be where we're supposed to be. Miscellaneous revenues, we never budget for those, but I figured I'd mention what's in there because there's $225,000 that will most definitely close to free cash because it wasn't budgeted for. And those figures are, I think it was $160,000 of it was insurance
arena.
Dividends.
Oh, the ice arena was a big one too.
Oh really? It didn't actually show up in this account.
Maybe it goes somewhere else.
The ice arena goes to its own revolving.
Right.
Is that the payments?
It goes to the general fund. The Reading Ice Arena Authority payment, which they made in mid-year sometime.
We put
I'm
in a
sure
revolving fund, and I used that as support into a regular, you know, we used to use it as support for the operating budget. I'll double check that,
okay.
But it did not show up here, so
okay.
It might be included somewhere else if I'm mistaken. But also we had $25,000 there where we received health insurance payments from other towns for retirees that had worked for our town, but also other towns, and they pay a portion, and about $25,000 that we got for sale of assets for DPW assets. So that was makes up that
it's
line.
An example of a dividend share from insurance.
I guess if we do trainings through Maya, they
oh,
give us
I
dividends
see.
Yeah,
for
it's like
that.
A credit.
Sharon, on the RMLD inflows, are there two different inflows? One is a larger number, like $2 million.
Yeah, there's an earnings distribution that they pay that's like $2.3 million.
Is that
in that's in the other.
That's
if
the
you
one.
Look under the other funding sources, that budgeted
oh,
amount of
okay.
$2.3 million, that's actually their earnings distribution. And
okay.
That did get collected. It
got
was 100% collected, which is wonderful.
Yeah.
What else did I want to mention?
Okay.
So this is the revenues. And so I think we are in
Sharon,
good shape here.
One question, delinquent property taxes. $165,000 is that Is that kind of, do we budget?
We don't budget for it because, yeah, I mean, it, you just don't know what you're going to collect. If people didn't pay their prior taxes, we have the ability to lien them. Mm-hmm. We will eventually get them, but it's hard to know the timeline, so we never project anything for it. And so that is, will help any shortfall you have in another area as well.
So $165,000 on $57 million, roughly?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a really, I mean, that's good.
Yeah.
But is this, you know, on a trend basis, is that better than usual, worse than usual?
I would say it's probably on par with what we normally see. We do always have delinquent taxes being paid in the following year because, you know, people don't want anything to happen. They get a lien, and certain they tend to pay.
So that's not a bad percentage.
It's better than water and sewer. It's a little higher for whatever reason.
If you
are there any inputs from the overlay reserve that can offset delinquent taxes? Is that not a possibility?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
The overlay reserve that the assessors keep?
Yep.
That's to cover unanticipated. I guess they have to adjust the property tax bill down.
Yeah, when I put in the budget for what we project for real estate taxes, I take it down by what the overlay is. So I project less than what we actually can collect. And so sometimes we'll collect more in real estate taxes, and that's what's happening is that we didn't have as many abatements or we didn't have as many uncollectible taxes. So.
And there's a second overlay surplus number that's in the budget. We've had the ability to do that for many years. And I don't remember the number, $350,000 comes to mind, something like
that. Yeah, $350,000.
And that's surplus that they have decided as a board they don't need. They reserve money against possible claims and reductions, and
that
$350,000,
back, right?
That's clear.
Yeah.
And they release amount
so
every
year. So we've
been
using that to support the budget each year. As they release, we use it towards the budget, which helps. On page two, just looking at, this is how the budget is voted at town meeting. It's broken down in summary format. For most of the town departments, we vote salary and expenses and capital all separate, so those individual line items cannot go over that 100%, so I'm always scanning that. And this kind of helped me figure out that I didn't do something for town meeting. Looking at administrative services at 79%, I did know that we hadn't hired that administrative services director, but at town meeting, we had brought it down, that wage line down to compensate for a lower snow and ice. I think we ended up going with a
75.
Yeah, it helped pay for certain things. We took down that budget knowing we didn't need it because towards the end of the year, we finally did hire. So that kind of, when I looked at that, I'm like, oh, I didn't do that entry yet. So this sort of thing kind of helps me catch things of that nature. In the public services area, there's like 59% at capital expenses, and there's a field improvement project for $200,000. I reached out to John Pito. I asked him, you know, where are we at? Is this going to close to free cash? Are you going to actually encumber this by year end? Because if they don't encumber it by the end of the year, it will close to free cash. So I try and give people that heads up. You know that this hasn't been expended. It hasn't been encumbered. You need to do that by June 30th.
Mechanically, what do you do to encumber?
Well, usually they have to have a signed contract to do it. So they have to have been through their RFP process and have a signed contract. And then they can just enter a requisition. It goes through the approval process and it gets encumbered. So when they issue a PO, it just puts the money aside.
Okay.
And then it will roll to the next year. So it keeps that money from closing out and it will bring it forward to the next year. So even if they don't have the work done by June 30th, that's fine. As long as there's a contract in place by June 30th.
Where do you carry those funds in suspense then for the following year? What account did it come back into here? Is it just
a sub-account? It goes to a reserve for encumbrance, and then it comes. What will happen on the line item is you'll see it close out, and then it will come in as a transfer in on their budget.
Okay.
So if they have a budget that starts off $200,000, and $200,000 is coming in from another, you're going to have a revised budget of $400,000 because the $200,000 coming forward is from POs from the prior year.
Just for your information, and this might be overkill. For town meeting, we do not show any encumbered funds. That just muddies the waters. It's only fiscal year that was voted and fiscal year that was voted that is spent.
Right.
All the department heads and others have an ability to run a budget that includes encumbrances or excludes encumbrances or only looks at encumbrances. But that's much more an accounting thing, not so much an ongoing finance.
But it is important for us to recognize that this money is going to close if you don't encumber it by year end or expend it. If the bill came in and we paid it, then it would be fine by June 30th. But if it's going to go into the next year, they absolutely need to encumber it and bring it forward. Because it's a PO is a kind of represents a contract that we entered into an agreement.
So it shows up as a liability on the balance sheet?
It shows up
in every,
yeah, not a liability, it's actually an equity account. It's a reserve for encumbrance account.
If I can just add as good a time as any for the board's information. Over the last 2 months, we've been running into some pretty serious issues in projects we're bidding out in terms of them not being adequately funded. So as an example, the Killam School had $200,000 for field work. The lowest bid came in as specified in the RFP at $290,000. So we have to rework the RFP. We're going to cut out something that we all agreed was really a luxury and will easily accommodate the bid. We were asking them to truck in a lot of fill to even the outfield. We'll have a crooked outfield. We'll keep hold field advantage. And then in the enterprise funds, it's just as bad. There's some water projects and there's some sewer station projects, you'll remember, that are just not coming in on budget. So we're going to be turning money back at the end of the fiscal year and starting all over, basically.
Projects don't get done.
They don't get done. We don't have the money.
And you can't encumber it and get a head start on next year.
No, she wouldn't let us.
Bob, do you find this is in relation to the fact that there's a lot of projects going on with other cities and towns around here, and it's just not the necessity for these contractors coming in?
I do think so. I think in some ways we're pricing ourselves out of the market. We're so busy. There seems to be more and more every year a more limited amount of contracts that are expert at a certain kind of work, like paving.
Mm-hmm.
There's a handful of people that ever bid on paving. It's not really much of a free market, unfortunately. And sewer station rehab. It turns out it's the same thing. Now, we hadn't done one in 50 years, so we didn't really know. Went to an engineering firm, got good estimates, and they are off by 100 or 200,000 out of 600,000, which isn't too bad, but we can't do it.
We don't have it. Yeah.
And the question is going forward, now that we've really been through a period of half a year or 3 months of poor results, should we be inflating our capital estimates? None of us like to do that, so we're going to have to figure it out. But we need to do a better job estimating the costs. We've just been, same with paving. Sometimes paving comes in, if you remember the Haverhill Street, came in $700,000 under budget. No one can explain that. And then some of these things come in hundreds of thousands over budget. When you're only seeing three bids, you're subject to how busy they are.
Mm-hmm. That's probably a reflection of what it is.
Yeah.
We bid out of state. Are we able to bring in New Hampshire vendors? Or
I don't know.
I think we can.
I think, yeah, it depends on how the RFPs are written.
I think
written,
they have to be licensed in state.
Usually Massachusetts experience for the most of what we do is preferred, but yeah.
Okay, moving on. We are on page 2. The other area I want to point out is under public safety, that percentage of 90% for salaries seems high. And it also pointed to something that needed to be done that I haven't done yet, and that is at town meeting we had voted to create a new salary line within the benefits to move disability retirees' salaries over there, and that's $151,000. Once I move that, it'll be about 80%, which is more in line with what you're seeing in the other areas, although public safety tends to have more OT, so that would kind of account for the rest. On page 3, I highlighted the school department, just to give you a couple of areas that I questioned there. The capital expenditures, it looks like there's almost $1 million left, and about $857,000 of that relates to roofing projects for Eaton and Parker. I asked Martha about them, and they're on the verge of getting a signed contract. They've already done all their RFP and awarded the bid. I think they've been combined, the two projects. And they're just waiting on a signed contract, and they will encumber, so those won't close out to free cash. And that's the majority of that, $969,000. The other thing that looks strange there is the professional salaries, which is where the teachers sit. Teachers are paid over 26 pay periods, and it goes through the summer. And so what happens at the end of the year is we accrue for that at June 30th, and so a lot of that's going to hit in this end of this month. Some of them take a lump sum payment at June 30th for their summer. Some of them get paid through the summer, but I accrue it at June 30th. So that will go to a normal number towards the end. And then on the next page, on page 4, looking at debt service, I noticed that it looked like debt service was over. In drilling into the expense line item, I noticed that all of the debt issuance costs went to this line item, which is where it normally would go. But because we had a premium when we offered up the debt, it actually belongs down in the other financing sources and uses section, and so I will have that moved, and that will resolve that issue. Other than that, employee benefits, if you look at that line item there for salaries, that is the new line item where the disabilities will be held that are going for retirement. And as you can see, that I put the budget there, I didn't put the actual wages there. So sometimes these things kind of help me point to what I forgot to do. And I think that's pretty much it for the financial aspect. Unless you have questions, we'll move on to the next topic. Linda Phillips had reached out to me and asked some questions prior to the vote for the modulars about the revolving funds and how much questions are asked of DOR about what can be maintained in them, and we ask a lot. And we do ask a lot of questions of DOR to help us, you know, decipher what we should be doing with some of these things, particularly in the area of the revolving funds, because since I've gotten here, I've had a lot of questions about it. And her question actually was put into an email, or she sent it to an email for DOR to answer her the question, asking if it was legal for the school to run an entrepreneurial business out of a taxpayer-owned building. and she was citing those growing revolving funds as kind of making profit. And she sent that email and was received by Gary Blow over at DOR DLS, which is the legal department over there, and he did respond and basically told her that these revolving funds are supposed to kind of revenues and expenditures pretty much match pretty closely. Obviously, you're going to have some excess, but they shouldn't be growing. They should be just funding the program. We're not in the business to be profitable. It should be just covering the cost of the program. And he also provides, so the information on this is from 5 to 10 in your packet. This is the email that was received back from Gary, the email from Linda to him asking the question, and then he gives a letter that he cites, where he actually highlights, and I think I highlighted for you because when I copied it, it didn't come up highlighted, but he sent her a letter that was an opinion letter sent back to someone else asking a similar sort of question that basically said, in our view, therefore, the fees and charges for participation in extended school services program, which is one of the revolving funds, must be calculated and used to offset the overall cost of or expenses of providing the service and not to produce a surplus or profit in excess of the cost of the program. So they're not supposed to be designed to make a profit. You can have a little excess in there, but we do have quite a bit. They are growing.
Sharon, how do you, in a case where not all the costs are allocated against the revolving account, say things like salary or heat, which are already part of the main operating budget, they may not be brought over as expenses or in full measure as expenses?
What is done currently is some costs are going directly to the revolving fund and being paid, like salaries that are directly related, but other things are paid out of the general fund
overhead,
appropriation,
lighting,
and then what we have is a revolving fund support coming in from the revolving fund to pay back the general fund for some of those costs, some of them being indirect costs, some of them being direct costs, depending on what's being charged to the general fund. What I've noticed since I've been here is that at the end of the year, well, when I first came in, I remember asking the director at the time, Mary, I'm going to be moving all the revolving fund support that the town has budgeted. Would you like me to move yours? And she said, no, we don't do that till the end of the year. We may not need it. And I didn't quite understand that because I thought, well, if you budgeted the support, it has to go. Because,
it has to go.
Yeah, because, you know, I didn't understand it. But her view was that there are reasons why you wouldn't take all of that support. Maybe the enrollment isn't what you thought it was going to be. All these different reasons. And that there should be a little bit of excess. And she believed, I think, there should be some excess, much like the circuit breaker, where they have a year of excess in those accounts. Because that gives them more flexibility, budget certainty, and things of that nature. So we differed on our opinion on it, and I cannot move any money on the revolving funds without her approval. The way it's set up in Munis, if I do a journal entry to take the support, she has to approve it. So there wasn't any way for me to just do it. And I wouldn't anyway, because it is her budget. But so we differed on how it should be done. And I'd asked several questions of DOR regarding it. Is there a limit of how much can be in these funds? Do they have to move that support? Like, you know, point me to the section of the law that tells me they have to, something that I can show her that this is what the way it should be done. And it just seemed like at that point, without finding anything that was, because it is very gray in the way that it's written in the law, there isn't any, you can't go over X amount in this funds or it closes back. There's nothing like that in the law that kind of helps you say, yes, you have to, you know, you can't grow these funds to, you know, 2 years worth of reserves. So essentially we just differed on it, and it, we did it however she wanted to do it. At the end of the year, we move it, maybe I think in July, after she probably evaluated where the school department, you know, landed. And I think that from my view, it appeared to me that she would have budgeted support and she would take less because she didn't need it, because maybe they didn't expend all of their budget. And so I felt like that meant that the general fund kind of absorb some of the costs for some of these revolving funds that should have been coming from the revolving funds.
The two questions come out of that. One is, if I understood what you said earlier, it's fine to accrue a positive balance in the account as long as you're assured that the operating account, that, that the expenses are in line with the revenues.
Because mm-hmm. I feel like the support that is budgeted is meant to capture all of the costs. So if you don't
correct.
Actually move all of it, I feel
correct.
Like you've kind of put some of the cost on the general fund by not doing it.
Aren't they allowed to sort of charge back, you know, like a piece of, you know, the principal's time, the custodian,
mm-hmm.
the school
yeah.
nurse, like
she's
so.
Saying they have to.
Right.
They
so that's
like we
so
do in our enterprise.
So even though that's not a direct cost to the program.
Indirect cost, or yeah, they should
so
be charging all the costs directly.
So it wouldn't be just, you know, if you have 100 kids at $100, you know, therefore you have to spend $10,000. You know, you can have a little bit more in there because there's some cost not just associated
mm-hmm.
with
yeah.
that.
Yeah, and since Martha has come in, she's been asking questions too, just not understanding why do we have all this money. You know, so if
right.
this is something that's been questioned by several people. The auditors are always asking about it,
right.
and Linda has asked about it, and I've asked about it, and I think the town accountant before me, everybody had different views on it, and there was nothing that we could kind of hang our hat on and say, my view on this is the right one. Linda's question was asked in February, and then we received our management letter comment from the auditors, and they made a recommendation to look at these revolving funds as well. So it kind of solidifies that we are doing something that's even highlighted to the auditor that doesn't seem to be quite in line with the way
maybe
it's meant to be done.
Plan.
Yeah, a recommendation that we make sure that our revenues and our expenditures are matched.
So that brings up my second question. Absent a law or a policy, could we not generate a reconciliation statement for each year to demonstrate what the actual costs and
mm-hmm.
the actual revenues are, irrespective of what the cash balance
Speaking
is?
To Martha, we are going to be working together to, number one, identify how the fees are established, how those supports are established, and what's in there, what should be in there that isn't in there, because there are probably some indirect costs that aren't thought of that should be in there.
Absolutely.
Health insurance.
I'm sure, I don't know, not seeing the detail that made up how they calculated their support, I don't know if they don't have health insurance in there. I would hope that they do, but if they don't, absolutely. So we're going to be, you know, drilling into each one of these funds with a fine-tooth comb and determining do the fees match up with the expenses? Are the fees too high? Or, you know, is there more
sure.
there than just not
sure.
taking all the support? Because
right.
to me it seems like if you budgeted support of $400,000 and you only transferred $300,000, you know, and the real cost are $400,000. If you keep doing
right.
that, you are going to build a balance.
You're
in that
gaming
fund.
It. You're also
yeah.
gaming it. So, I'm sorry, Dan, one last. So, I get it for going forward. You want to match revenues and expenses. How do you unwind? How do you unring the bell?
One of the recommendations that the DOR person had recommended was if you determine that the fees were too high, that maybe you should be refunding back to those people who made the payments. But the other thing that was pointed to in the opinion letter is that once they're in that fund, once they're in a fund that's kind of, you know, full day kindergarten or extended day, they have to be used for that program.
Purpose.
And so you can't just say, well, you know, some of the revolving funds, like the inspections when we used this past April town meeting voted to use that to help us offset some of our snow and ice. We couldn't do that with any of these school ones. They
yeah.
absolutely have to be used for what
but you could very well before the end of the year fully assess the full expense, bring the full support into the school budget, and then the excess at the end of the school flows back into free cash.
Sure.
true?
Yes, and that will be done this year, but I think that you can only put in what the cost of the program is for the year,
right.
And anything that's happened in the past,
understand.
It's going to take a while to get these to go down, right. Because we've built up so much excess. I mean, the comment from the management letter said that we had between 6 and 24 months of excess in these revolving funds. And the management letter comment doesn't specify that it is for the school revolving fund, so I question that. I said, do you have concerns on the town side?
Right.
Because you're not saying school. I know that you asked me specifically questions about our school revolving, but do you have concerns about the town? And he said, no, I just kind of, you know, to be kind, just kind of said revolving funds in general, but I am very concerned about the school ones because they're the ones that are growing.
Okay. Were there any town side revolving funds that were identified as having surplus?
The biggest revolving fund that we have on the town side is the inspections permit
yeah.
one. And that's the one we used at town meeting to help support the snow and ice.
Right.
And that we've been talking about kind of how that should be used and if there is too much in there. We've been having meetings to discuss.
Those generally go down to zero when we have a project, don't they? I mean,
we don't have a lot of experience with it, to be honest with you. It's something that should have been set up for the landfill and was not. And so it was set up for these three big projects.
Because I thought we usually expended those.
No. It's a hard, for one thing, there's three projects. Two of them are not yet complete. One of them is. Oak Tree is done. The other two aren't. When those are done, then we know there's no more revenue coming in. There is right now no method. The town manager is the spending authority, but normally the things I would spend money on, town meeting has to approve.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't just say, let's go spend $100,000 and have a party, much as I'd like to. Any amount that even town meeting wants to spend is limited by $200,000 a year, and there's about $500,000 in there now. So town meeting would have to vote to change the policy on the revolving fund, for instance, in order to empty it out and say, now you have the authority to spend $500,000. And right after that, we're going to empty the whole thing out to pay for snow and ice. And that may well be a solution down the road when the projects
are
done.
Well, we actually have the power to vote money out of that revolving fund where we don't
yeah.
have the power
right.
with these ones, which is a big.
Right.
But I do feel like regardless of what the direction was of the recommendation, all the revolving funds are going to get looked at, whether it be school or town, just to be sure that they are being used appropriately,
sure.
that we aren't, you know, overlooking anything here.
One question. I'm looking at Kathleen Colleary's letter on page 9. She's chief of the Bureau of Municipal Finance Law.
Mm-hmm.
And the section you highlighted in yellow, when you're talking about the fees and charges for participation in the extended school services program, that they have to be used to offset the overall costs or expenses. Now, let's stipulate something like full day K. This is something I've heard. I'm not an expert in this, but that the constituent pieces of that fee include costs for health care that is budgeted in there,
mm-hmm.
and that's collected into the revolving fund. Do you know if any of those funds are then dispersed to the appropriate line item on the town side?
The way that things are done, especially when it comes with health insurance, it's all paid out of one line item. So what's happening is just a revolving fund support is just one line item that it comes in as a revenue source. And it's basically repaying the general fund for the expenses that it paid on behalf of that.
Okay, so that is accounted.
Yeah, it's accounted for, but on the individual lines. But what you'll see when the support comes in is just almost like a revenue item, money coming
okay.
in from the revolving fund to support the general fund budget.
Very good. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sharon, I'm interested in this particular topic as we think about trying to find other nickels and dimes. Would you be willing to come back before this board, maybe in first quarter in the new year, and just summarize what actions were actually taken and
okay.
how you saw this Gordian knot?
Okay. No problem.
It'd be interesting.
Yeah, it should be interesting. Now, I think in the packet on page 11, that just kind of shows you, this is what Martha had provided to FinCom. FinCom had even asked the question, what do you have in your revolving funds? I don't know if somebody had asked them, but this was what was provided, and you can see the growth of each one of the funds from year to year. Just figured I'd put that in there. When I had requested from DOR, you know, how much can be in these funds? I got this on page 12, 13, and 14. This is what DOR sent me, and it basically tells you each one of the revolving funds related to the school, what law it falls under, what they can be used for, but nowhere on here does it talk about a limit or, you know, it just, it's kind of, you know, this is what they gave me when I asked the question, so. So that being said, as far as the audit, it just seemed coincidental that Linda would ask this question and then the auditors came back with a recommendation to look at these revolving funds a little more closely, just make sure that we are matching our revenues with the expenses. And I think if we take the full amount of support, I think we'll find that we're probably are, most of the costs are probably in there. But there are probably indirect costs that maybe haven't been thought about that really should be applied there, and that might help us bring down some of those balances. They could be doing some enhancements to some of these programs to help use up some of these funds. They might want to consider lowering fees to try and get the balances to go down quicker, or refunding fees if they, if we determine that maybe the fees were too high, that when you analyze it, if it looks to be that the expenses don't equal out to what the revenues are, maybe we should be providing refunds. There's some options, but there's no option that says, oh, at town meeting we can vote to use this to support the budget above and beyond. You just can't do that. So we'll see what Martha and I come up with as we dig into, you know, what's really going on. How did they, you know, because Martha's coming into this too, and the support had already been calculated, so we've got to look at how did they arrive at these numbers? What's the backup that supports this? Obviously, there should be support, so if there isn't, then we have a bigger problem. So, but I think that looking into it, and Martha seems to be in agreement that we are going to work on this together, and we want to do this right, so. And Martha's here today. And I think that for every comment that we get, I always get upset when I see a comment from the auditors. But I think we all want to do things right, and sometimes things like this come up, and we just it kind of makes us focus our attention in the area that needs to be.
Sure.
So there's just so much that I don't think you can have your arms around everything. At a, you know what I mean? It just it, you know, we're very short-staffed in some ways. And so sometimes we need those auditors to point us in the direction of where things might be
absolutely
going a little bit awry.
It's more important what you do now than that something was pointed out.
And the auditors did say, you know, that, you know, working with Martha, working with me, that we're very responsive, and when they bring about concerns, we are responding to those concerns, that management comments aren't being repeated, that they're seeing results the next time they come out. So that's a good thing. The audit on the whole really did go well. They did even compliment us on, you know, just even in general, they're talking about how the pension liability in the next year will be showing on the balance sheet, and
that's
how
good.
And it's going to make it an ugly looking balance sheet because the numbers are going to go negative on the equity side. But they also said that right now our OPEB liability does show on our balance sheet, and we're one of the few communities they see that that number isn't negative, even with that huge OPEB liability sitting there. So, you know, just a positive, just talking about how well financially managed the town appears to be, you know, as we do have a AAA bond rating, you know, for a small town like this, that's a very big plus.
Sure. Do you have a target for your completion of your analysis with Martha?
We've talked about it. We haven't kind of had a timeline put in place, but we have a deadline to, you know, to come up with a presentation for the board. We'll certainly have to get one put together. I mean, we had planned on looking at it right away because it is a concern for year end in terms of what those supports are and if there could be more. So, but we didn't have a date like a we have to have this done.
Mark, did you have a comment?
Well, I was going to say on May 18th, I reported to the school committee about the audit finding, and I committed to them to Sharon and I were going to work together on it over the next 6 months and get back to them in 6 months. It's kind of the time frame that I communicated to the school committee. So.
Okay.
I don't want to belabor this, but just looking at these lists of funds, I mean, there's probably a couple of dozen of them. You know, just picking one that I actually am familiar with, but, you know, drama activities, Parker, because we used to be a drama family. I mean, I think it's really important to note that, you know, while we want to try to get the expenditures and the revenues to match, it shouldn't be an expectation that at the end of every fiscal year there's going to be zeros in here.
No,
you know,
I don't think that's
right.
What the expectation is.
Just because, I mean, you know, you're going to have to, the parents are really good at fundraising 1 year, so there's more money in there. They paid for the plays, but now they have to spend some money next year before the new fundraising stuff.
I think they're really focused on programs like full-day kindergarten, extended
right.
day. The ones
and those
where,
are the big ones.
Yeah, those
but,
are the bigger ones.
But there's other ones in here that, you know, can generate some positive, you know, some positive revenues,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I just hope the expectation is not to look
no,
at this at the end of the year just to see zero.
Given when you're, because yeah, they are in the mix, but I think they're really focused
okay.
more on programs like Full Day Kindergarten, Extended Day, and things of that nature, where we're charging a fee out to parents for Full Day Kindergarten. Are we charging too much is the concern.
To Barry's point, I think the objective is zero, relatively speaking, zero growth, not zero balance.
Yeah. Right? We just shouldn't be growing it at the
correct
pace that we are. I mean, I think having some reserves in there, I don't think is necessarily a
right
bad thing.
Right.
And I mean, Martha and I talked about it. It seems prudent to have it for budget certainty, to know that when you're budgeting support for the next year that you have a certain amount already in there, because there are people that, you know, might be in your extended day that might not pay right away. You might have some
right
uncollectibles.
Yeah.
There
sure
might be some things that you just don't know are going to happen. You want to have a little extra in
mm-hmm
there. But we shouldn't be growing it at the rate that we are. And so it just kind of highlighted to the auditors, seeing this happening, that maybe we're not paying enough attention.
Probably not $3.5 million.
No, no. And I don't think, you know, I mean, there are probably reasons for some of them that Mary could speak to better, you know, but now she's gone, so we can't.
Silly question, Bob. How do we pick the auditor, Valence and Heath? How is that selected?
RFP.
Okay.
Every, what, 3 years, 6 years?
I think we have a 3-year contract.
Are they happy with them so far?
I enjoy working with them. I feel like they are very responsive. You know, they're already scheduled to come out and start preliminary field work for the fiscal 15. They answer all my questions. And interestingly enough, one of the management letter comments that they had last year did repeat itself, and it was the
GASB
54 fund balance policy.
Oh, yeah.
I asked them, geez, do you have an example of what this is supposed to look like? I mean, because I wanted to make sure that I didn't miss anything.
Right.
I'd never had an auditor ask for something like that. And they said, oh, when we get one, I will give it to you. And that was over a year ago. I just received two.
That's why they keep putting it on the management letter. They want an example.
She said
formats of it just 2 months ago. But they did get back to me, but over a year later. And so it is something that most people were like, geez, recreate the wheel. What needs to be in here, you know? And they're basically just kind of looking for us to formalize a policy that kind of really already takes place in terms of when we have a project, say like the library project, and maybe we've got free cash going there, we've got a grant, and maybe we're doing some borrowing. What is the order of which we use those funds? You know, do we use the free cash first? Do we use that? You know, and we tend to use grant money and bond, you know what I mean? Like, it's all about those choices that you make in terms of what money gets used first when you have multiple funding sources, and putting that on paper and knowing the Board of Selectmen and FinCom know that that's the way it's done. So that's part of it. And then also a reserve, what we kind of, an internal policy of what we keep in reserves, what we don't want to fall below. We do have a FinCom policy, but they call it a fund balance policy.
I understand.
That includes everything, not just free cash. So it's a little bit different, and I do have a couple examples. I had drawn up a draft of what I thought they wanted before I went on maternity leave, but when I went looking for examples, I saw some more detailed information and started questioning, geez, do I have everything I need to in here? So this example helped me figure out, this is what they've already taken from another town, and they believe it's complete. I can look through mine and say, yes, I covered all of this. So I would expect sometime by the end of the summer we will be seeing that up in front of you for approval, hopefully.
Okay.
I'm trying to think, June 22nd, I believe, is the date they're coming out for preliminary field work, and then they usually come out in September to start the actual field work after we close the year, which is a pretty extensive process.
Okay, yes.
Since we have the convenience of you sitting here, if it's at all possible, I'd urge them to act hastily for this year end. We're going to have some challenges setting the tax rate this year, just so you know. Victor and I have talked. The early retirement package is hitting DOR hard, and it's going to be a real scramble in the fall for communities to try to set their tax rates. We already know this six months in advance.
Our DOR rep is retiring. And she had said to me that they were potentially going to bring some of those people that are retiring back in to help
with the tax rating process, just for that one year,
so it's not mass confusion, because it's such an important process.
Yeah.
More than even the free cash, the tax rating
right
setting.
You can't send out tax bills without
exactly
a tax rate.
and so that's the area where I think
we'll
they're going to probably bring
some
of those people back who chose the retirement,
and
I'm hoping that they do that, but absolutely we want to expedite the process and make sure that we're not the ones sitting there not getting our tax rate set.
Great.
Any other questions from the board?
Nope. Sharon, anything else?
No, nope, I think that's
thank
it.
You. Comprehensive.
Thank
you.
Any comments from
you
folks here?
You don't believe that.
Thank you very much. We look forward to working together.
Thanks, Sharon.
Okay.
Thanks.
And the hour is upon us, 8 o'clock, and we have a hearing on the driveway.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on June 2nd, 2015 at 8 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on a driveway variance at 137-139 Salem Street. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Mondays, Wednesday, and Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on June 2nd, 2015 to the town manager at ci.reading.ma.us.
Thank you, Kevin. Just for the benefit of everybody that's come in, if you would please sign the roster and come in the list of visitors.
Yeah.
If you're here for either the Birch Meadow or for this hearing, we would appreciate it. There's also copies of agendas up there. You're the proponent, sir?
Yeah, I'll just give a quick introduction and then introduce Al. In your packets tonight, you have comments from the DPW director, town engineer, and police chief. All indicating they don't have a problem with this.
Okay, consider those entered into the record?
Yes. On the map behind me, we have the current condition on the left, the proposed condition on the right. With that, I'll turn it over to Al Couliard, the developer of the site. Al?
Hey, Al.
Hi.
Thank you.
I'm Al Couliard. I'm purchasing 137-139 Main Street. I'm going to raise the existing two-family and build this proposed two-family. So I'm proposing to separate these two driveways into an existing driveway. And the topography on the driveway, I don't know if you're familiar with the lot on Salem Street, the topography goes downhill here. So this is a what I would call a flush grade garage, and this is a garage under. So the existing, you can see, is, I can't see the numbers on here, but it's 40-something.
50 feet or something.
49
like
feet,
yeah,
or so between the existing, and we're going to 81 feet and separating these two out. So I think overall we'll be improving the conditions of the property.
The standard, Bob, for separation is what?
100.
But he's actually lessening the non-conformance.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, decreasing the non-conformance.
Okay.
I don't know if you guys care about that. I do have a photo of the,
sure,
the property that I'm proposing to construct.
Okay, questions from the board?
I think, Mr. Chairman, I actually drive down the street every day to take my son to the school bus, and that is a really, really busy street. And on Sunday, I actually went and parked my car and walked it. And one concern that I have is that, it's going to be a nice building, but that we're sort of creating two instances where we have driveways that are very, very, very short distance apart, emptying out into a busy street. And then you have Pierce Street coming down. So, you know, in the morning when Salem Street is really backed up, like 7:30, it's hard to kind of see if you have the person in your two family and then the person to the left of that trying to get out. There's not a really big difference. And I'm just wondering, is there anything in the code that talks about how far the driveways have to be apart between two separate properties? Because you have your proposed two family, then you have, I think it's 131, and then the existing driveway over there. They seem to be very, very close together. And I don't know if there's...
I don't know.
There isn't. I asked the engineers that. It seems like a logical question. If you're going to have a distance for two driveways on one house.
Right.
But no, there isn't.
Because those are going to be very, very close together. And if someone's backing out of there and someone's coming down Pierce Street and you're trying to get onto Salem Street, either going, you know, toward the Rotary or toward Reading, I could see that being problematic.
Bob, these the kind of concerns the chief may have thought about?
No.
Or?
No, well, I'm sure he thought about it. He didn't have one. But again, to remind you, this is a shared driveway now.
Yeah.
And there are other examples of shared driveways in town on busy streets. If you think by Austin Prep.
Well, the shared driveway is on the right-hand side
right
now.
One point I would make is that on the driveway that you're concerned about on this side,
on that side, yeah.
This unit would have the availability to back out and pull forward out onto Salem Street, which I think is a huge advantage. And as, like you said, as opposed to backing out,
yeah,
those people will be pulling out forward every time they leave the
yeah
property.
And that driveway on the left-hand side is, you could barely fit
it's
a Toyota
yeah
in there, and they have to back out. So that's
yeah
already an existing
right
kind
yeah
of
it's already a
problem. But I just.
Okay, other questions from the board? Any questions from public? Comments? Yes, please just identify yourself and
yeah
your address.
I'm Molly Baker, and this is my husband Brian Haley. We live, we have the shared driveway currently, and we're on 143 Sims.
Mm-hmm.
And so we just wanted to, I guess, understand more how it would impact us since we're going from a shared driveway to a non-shared driveway, which we're actually proponents of.
Yeah, I would think you'd be happy about that.
For many reasons, including the one that you brought up, where it's difficult to kind of come in and out, especially when you're sharing it, people are coming in and out all the time. But I guess our concerns are related to what happens to that shared piece that's gone.
It's going
to
be gone. It'll be grass.
Okay.
Yeah.
And when would that all be taking place? Is there any kind of time frame?
In the next, hoping to gain a waiver from the board tonight. In a reasonable time frame, probably 2 to 4 months.
Okay. And that piece of it would happen in that time frame?
Yeah.
Okay. Would that be an early piece or?
Yeah.
Piece?
Well, what would happen is the first step would be to raise the existing building, and then part of that, I would probably clean up that whole edge and cut yours and clean the driveway up and make it better and start grading there. Probably
so the edge of our driveway would look like, how would that look?
I'll probably cut it. So it'll be clean and neat, and then I'll loom up to it. So from the edge of your driveway to the edge of the proposed driveway on that plane right there would be loomed and seamed.
Okay.
Lawn area.
Okay. And then in that kind of buffer zone where there's going to be grass,
yes,
are there any plans to do anything else, like trees or fences or anything that we should know about? Because the house comes, the proposed dwelling comes very close to our.
Yeah, I think it's actually going to be farther away from the existing one, but
it will definitely be closer.
Oh, it's,
yeah, it's
way
closer.
Closer.
Well, I can't. Your house isn't
on
this
right
plan, so this is you right here, right?
Yeah. So this is.
Yeah.
The
so
piece
where is your house? I don't know.
where you're basically pushing
this,
it right
this,
onto that dotted
piece
line, which is where an existing tree is right now.
This.
Right here. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're basically bumping out at least 7 feet,
no,
10
there
feet.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Right.
So yeah, so we're going right here. I don't have an issue with a plan for a shrub or some sort of buffering.
Well, we didn't.
Between, well, it benefits
it's not,
both parties.
Yeah, and
yeah
we didn't necessarily, have a preference right away. We just kind of
okay
wanted to know if there was part of the plan.
Yeah, we could talk about that.
And then I guess our
the other thing is the house is quite high at the moment, and I guess I just was wondering how. I understand. I don't know if this is the forum to talk about this stuff.
Yeah.
Or not. So
it's
not.
Right. I can give you my card.
We can talk.
And we can talk.
Because
yeah
I
was worried about the driveway.
Just the driveway. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. I'll talk to them after
CBCD.
Thank you. Probably. Any other comments from the audience? Further questions from the board? If there are no further questions. It's the board's pleasure to close the hearing.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the second driveway request for 137-139 Salem Street.
Okay, second. Discussion on closing the hearing. All in favor? 4-0, the hearing is closed.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the proposed driveway separation for 137-139 Salem Street as indicated on the plan by Christensen and,
Sergi.
Okay. Thank you. Sergi Inc., dated April 16th, 2015, subject to the following conditions. One, that the applicant submit a grading plan to engineering for review and approval as a substantial grade differential exists to each of the abutting properties. And two, that the existing shared driveway does not have an outstanding legal document prohibiting this action.
Motion seconded.
Second.
Discussion.
All in favor? Vote is 4-0. The motion carries.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thanks.
Okay. And now, we are now moving to the Birch Meadowfield lighting discussion. John Fiuto is here. John, is there a presentation you want to make?
There is. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, then I will give an opportunity for the audience to ask questions. We're here to talk about all aspects of this development, hours of use, potential parking, how we're going to vector the parking for different uses and that kind of thing. So,
great.
Thank you. Go ahead, John.
I just wanted to do two quick things. Introduce my chairman of the Recreation Committee, Mr. Rich Hand, is here tonight with us. And he's going to hate that I do this, but one of the board members from Reading Little League, Tom Frado, is in the back. So we've got good representation from the users and people that have the jurisdiction over the park. What I'm hoping to do tonight is just talk about, number one, the project, try to give a little bit of an update of where we are with the project. Talk about current and future concerns that the neighbors might have. And I'm most interested in hearing from the neighbors. I think that's going to be the most productive part of the evening for us. But they can't really comment until they really know what we're doing. So I'm going to try to give you as much insight on that as I can. I want to talk about neighborhood league and town collaboration, because the only way this will work productively is for all three of us to work together in harmony and try to work through concerns, questions. And we're going to use all that input and data to build an operation plan. We'll try to execute that operation plan to facilitate this process to the best of our ability and to try to make this work for all parties involved. So just quickly about the process, tonight is one of our first neighborhood meetings. I venture to think this will be the first of at least three. I can see the Recreation Committee certainly holding a more in-depth meeting once we've got more, say, nuts and bolts screwed together. We still go through a conservation filing for borings for the project that will be done. It's actually being worked on currently, and we'll be ready for July 1st for borings. We can't do anything for the project until we have borings dug, because that's going to trigger how foundations are created and how the project will actually be procured. So one thing kind of leads into another, so we have to kind of follow the step A, step B, step C. Procurement of the project would actually take place sometime in August, and we're hoping to do installation in the fall. I believe fall is very vague. It could be September, it could be October. It could very much depend on conservation and the process of trying to procure these lights. So on to the good stuff.
John, before you go on, the boring,
it's not very exciting.
It's mostly for conservation aspect or the construction aspect?
It's for the construction aspect, so they can actually design the foundations for the poles themselves.
Thank you.
Sure. So this looks big and scary with 27 light poles going up. Currently have 17 down there. I'll run through the fields quickly, just for those that haven't seen our elaborate names on our fields. I'll start it with the Little League field and work my way around. So the Little League field that we currently call Tennis Court Field would have poles, and these aren't exact. I pulled them off. I had to kind of superimpose because we're not at the stage yet where we have anything solid from a company, really.
And this is new lighting.
This is all new lighting. These would be where poles would go. The poles would stand anywhere between 50 and 70 feet tall, depending on the light needed. So we would start with the Little League field. We'd light that to a degree good enough to play a Little League baseball game there at night. What we'd be doing on Turf 2, which is currently lit, is removing the 8 poles and replacing with 4. And the 4 poles would now give us the same light, actually much better light, than what we're currently providing there, even with less fixtures. Moving up to the softball field area, this is where it gets a little tricky and a little hard to follow. There's lights that will go pretty much around the circumference of this unlit field. It's currently unlit. There's 2 baseball fields there with poles basically by each infield and down each line, illuminating the whole area. What this will in fact do is will allow us to play softball or baseball on these fields and also utilize this middle area however we want, but it will be lit good enough to play a flag football game, a high school soccer game, whatever we need to play there. So that would be a huge advantage. Working our way over to the lighted softball field, we call it the lighted softball field because it already has lights. So we don't have to change the name, it's great. But we would be supplanting, I believe we have, 9 poles already on this field. We'd be taking out those 9 and replacing them with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 poles. So we'd be reducing the poles on this field by two. And this would give us high enough to play ASA softball, high school fast pitch softball in the evening time, which would be a new advantage for the town. Moving on to Morton Field, which is one of our 390-foot baseball diamonds in town, we would be looking to put six poles, two on the infield. If you've noticed, there's a kind of a theme, there's always two right on the infield. The way they measure that is they go down the baseline 25 feet and they go out 25 feet. So it's consistent on all the fields, and that gives you the greatest foot candle on your infield, obviously where your hardest hit balls are and where your pitchers are standing not too far away from aluminum bats. And then you'll have one down both right and left field line, and then you'd have both kind of what we call the power alleys to give you maximum lightage. You can do up to eight on Morton. We tried to scale that back, thinking about the consideration of what we have. We don't lose anything by doing that. What they would do, in essence, is add a few fixtures to these back poles and these two poles to try to make up for the two poles we're not putting in, so we can enjoy the proper foot candles there. So that's just a quick overview of where they would go. And
Mr. Can you comment on the type of lighting in terms of its confinement to the field rather than the scattered lighting?
Can we talk about the lights? Can we talk about poles?
Sure.
John, you've mentioned poles on the skating side as well.
Yep.
Where are they playing for? The skating room?
The skating? These are already existing. Those would not be.
They're not shown.
They're here, but they're not. They're the old poles. Okay. So they're not shown. They're actually, there's 10 of them on, five on each side.
We talked about it, but as part of the pole project, is you thought to erect a net onto the name of the road that winds away around the field.
It's Birch Meadow.
Birch Meadow Drive. Sometimes, actually, a baseball has come flying into Birch Meadow Drive.
Here.
Any thought about putting a net up there to try to?
We've talked about it, and they actually work. They're quite functional. We just, if you've been down there recently, you might have noticed, we actually just put one up over here to protect the tennis players.
Yeah.
And I was a little nervous when we put it up, and I drove down there, and I was like, oh, it didn't go up yet, and it was actually there.
Yeah.
It is, because it's black, it's almost invisible. So I'm very amenable to doing that, as long as we can get the funding to do it.
I assume it's the same poles.
It would actually come off the fence. You wouldn't actually put it off. I wouldn't put anything off the light poles, just because that works in contrast with your warranty. The second you start attaching things to it, they're gonna.
Yeah. Did you respond to my question on the directional nature of the lighting that you're using?
Sure. The company that we're talking to, there's a co-op that we can buy off of, is Musco, and that's the company we plan to work with. They are the leader in the industry. They use reflectors on their fixtures to basically, they can tell us exactly where the light spillage will be, and I can actually show you an example of that in a few minutes. But they've got, it's not your old floodlights that we used to have, and the floodlights that we have now, that they bear out almost instantly. They're reflected and they can direct light in a very, very high efficient way. The system that we're talking about is called the green system, and it's called the green system because it's efficient and they don't waste light. So they don't need to put extra fixtures up to direct it, because the lights that they have are put in a position where they're going to give you the maximum lumens and foot candles that you're looking for.
John, the poles that are coming down versus the poles that are coming up, is there a height difference?
The poles on Morton Field, I believe, are going to be 70 feet tall. I believe the poles on the three softball fields are 50 feet tall, and I believe the ones on here are either 50 or 60.
But the existing poles that you're taking down, how tall are those?
Offhand, I don't know. They're not nearly, they're probably 30 footers.
30?
Yeah, they might be 30 or 40. They're not nearly as tall, and they don't give the same foot candles. The higher you go, obviously, the more spread you get.
And I imagine they're going to be situated in a way where you don't have to put tires around them to protect your left field.
Yeah, there will still be, but we will do padding around them instead of the tires were a great idea probably in the 70s, but it's antiquated. But you could actually, they sell pads that you can actually sleeve them with that look a lot nicer and attractive.
Yeah.
Real quickly on the Morton Field, you talked about the you could put up to eight. I assume you'd put two of those in the outfield.
Yep.
You're going to use directional cans. Is that what you said on the two existing that you have proposed here? To compensate for that center field?
What they'll do is they'll actually add fixtures to the bank. So instead of having, and I'm throwing a number because I don't have the exact, but instead of putting 12, they'll put 14 or 16 on the bank of lights. If you can imagine the stadium field, we've got actually only four, we only have four poles for this field.
Okay.
Similar. Instead of putting six poles, they put four and they just put more lights on it.
Okay. So it's nothing that's going to, would increase or decrease the lights spillage by having extra poles?
It should not, no. The spillage will be the spillage, and I'll show you, I actually have, that's the one thing that we did try to overlay with engineering, and the information that we had was we were able to see where the foot candles would lie out here, and I can present that.
Okay.
Yeah, that tonight, or are you?
Oh yeah, I have it. I have it in hard copy. It's too hard to see on the screen,
okay.
So I actually brought a hard copy in.
John, I'm looking ahead to the second, whenever the second part of the project actually gets kicked off. Is there any part of the engineering here that dovetails with any future work, electrical, foundational?
So there's going to be a snack.
Currently there's a snack shack and some pavilion type structure going into this area. I'm not sure that we would tie in quite yet. What will happen currently is these lights would tie into the tennis box because we already have a tennis, we already have a pretty large box to handle that load. We would tie these right into this existing box here, and these would run into here.
So you don't see any particular savings in terms of trenching or cabling, any changes you make now to make the next phase that much easier?
No, the savings that we'll have is doing all this at once, and it will be encompassed in this project. It's too hard to project that laying future. If there's an opportunity to lay future, we would, but I don't have an exact, until I have the design of how they're actually going to dig, we wouldn't really know. Sure. Thank you. So if you build it, they will come, and they will come in the daytime too. So I just wanted to point something out that I noticed recently. I was down at a high school baseball game, I think it was last Tuesday, meeting one of my tennis instructors, and I looked around. It was a busy night at the complex, and there were cars everywhere. You can see there's actually Wilmington's bus is right there waiting to pick the kids up after the game. There's parking on all sides. If you had gone down Hotshorn and gone around the neighboring streets, the people are parked everywhere. I actually drove down. I had to do a three-point turn and go back around, and I ended up parking at the high school. I said, number one, I think I should take a picture of this because this would be a good representation of that. The lights are one thing, but parking is an issue that we need to solve whether we put lights up or not. So I have some ideas that we've been kind of kicking around with staff. We've been kicking around the Birch Meadow Master Plan Committee. I'd like to share some of those. And we talked about even if we have enough handicap spots and whether or not some of these, some of the parking should be restricted. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about that. And some of the other questions that I thought might come up. So here's some of the questions that I think should be asked and should be answered. And I'm not saying I have all the answers tonight, but these are some of the recommendations that I can think of off the top of my head. So parking would be to restrict, let me go back here for a second, restrict parking on the resident side. I think that would be a great step. I know if I lived there, I wouldn't want people driving on the edge of my grass. I can only imagine how annoying it is to have that happen or have people pulling into my driveway to turn around constantly. So that's something that I think the Board of Selectmen could probably work with the PTTF. Staff group and come up with a pretty good solution for.
Adjacent streets like Archshorn and Hanscom.
Yeah, I mean, that should be under consideration. I think, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that, Dan, is trying to find a way to facilitate traffic getting out of that particular neighborhood. And I think there's ways to do it, and I think part of it is, and that was kind of my thinking when I went down there that day. I went all the way down the end like everybody does, and I got trapped. And I said, what do I do now? So I got me thinking of, how would we do? I played on that field as a kid. I remember it's a habit that you just by nature drive down there. What if we change that habit for kids that are playing on it now and find ways to get people to get in the habit of actually going to the high school? So we actually vetted some ideas, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that. But maybe making that tennis parking only tennis parking. The tennis courts are used enough to definitely justify that, something we could definitely consider. And putting all the baseball parking at the field house. And I think there's ways to do that. At least in the interim, until we have a better solution or a solution that we can vet and afford to actually carry out. A big question, obviously, would be what the light schedule will be. And I think the Recreation Committee is very interested in trying to do the light schedule in a way that is reasonable for residents. We did that with the varsity football stadium, in which we have a different schedule for a Thursday night than we do for a Friday night, because it's on the weekend. And I think that's certainly something the Recreation Committee will be open to. Will there be spillage? Yeah, there will be a little spillage, and I can talk a little bit about that. In some places, we have a what they would call a 10% or 0.1 foot candle, which is probably just a little bit darker than what we're at now. Another 10 minutes will be at what they call deep twilight. So they give you a sense of, you know, the kind of light that you're going to get from a very, very light foot candle. And the other question I think people would want to know is, you know, what's being done about noise control? And I think noise control and vehicle maintenance go and kind of hand in hand. I think if you have people slamming car doors 25 feet away from your house, it's noisy. I think groups tend to congregate after games and talk about the game. It's mm-hmm. noisy. So I think if you can find a way to pull that activity away from the residences, I think it sets it up to work a little bit better. So that being said, I wanted to share a little bit of some of the things that we've talked about. We tried to take a proactive approach already. I've been in contact with Reading Babe Ruth, Reading Little League, and I've asked them to let their teams know to start creating that habit, to start parking. I'm going to run back a couple slides just so I can show you where I'm talking about. Actually, it's not on that slide.
It's close enough.
Well, we're going to ask people to park in this lot, and this is by GPS, 62 Oakland Road. So if you actually punch in 62 Oakland Road, that's where it's going to drop you. So we're going to ask that the baseball users park in this lot and just find their way over. And we can light this area too if we need to with some walk lights. That's not a big deal.
There's a path there. It's actually a great walk
if you've done it. It's a great walk, and it's very short. It's maybe from this parking spot maybe 3 minutes. And we were going to ask the Little League folks to park in the what we call the Rise lot or the Superintendent's lot, which actually dumps you right on the field. If you're playing on this field, I don't know why you'd park here, because it's a much more hassle of a walk. So creating those habits would be very, very helpful, and I think would be a way to mitigate some of the parking issues that we're having down there.
Okay. Quick question in regards to that. If you bring that back up, actually,
sure.
I'd appreciate it. So that little area, you said, we'll light this little area. I see a big wooded area there that looks like a giant parking lot to me.
It's a hill with a high and low ropes course on it for the high school. The high school actually uses it as part of their sophomore curriculum.
Okay. My question is that something that is non-negotiable? Is that kind of where you're going with from a parking standpoint to you know move that to another part of the complex?
There would be a
project.
It would be quite big, and I'm not sure. Anytime you take away open space like that's a nice open natural resource.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure you'd want to commit it to parking.
And was there something on the master plan as well too, which you can't see on the site with the Rise parking area?
Yep.
About extending that out. Mm-hmm. I know there's a right now an unused used to be what a volleyball court or something.
No, there is actually if you pan down a little bit, there is a basketball court down there.
Right.
That could be talked about as excess parking, and that would be something that. We're actually running pickleball in there, which is very popular and upsets some people. But that would be another area that you could move pickleball really anywhere.
Okay.
But that would be another spot where you could fit more cars.
Okay.
Sure. But again, that's also near residences, so you're bringing cars closer to residences again. So it's just something to think about. I forget the name of it. What road's coming down?
Longfellow.
Yeah, thank you. So there is a road.
Now, while you're on this, maybe to Kevin's point, not while removing the hill, but is there a way to put a continuation of the traffic pattern so that you don't dead-end the crowd coming down?
Stealing my thunder. I actually have a slide on that. Yeah, we've actually, and I'll talk a little bit more about it later, but, and excuse the, this is an old photo of the complex, but this is Bancroft Ave. It would be perfect if there was a way to actually continue one-way traffic right into the parking lot.
Park here.
Yep. Don't park here. Continue your way through and park. If there was a way to do that, and I think there is. There's certainly enough space there. The courts actually end about here, and there's a big open space here that could be also parking if needed. But if not, you could drive people right through.
You could put the drive-through for the pavilion there too.
You could, and that's something that we could gate as well too when we're not in use.
You
right?
could gate
I'm
it.
I'm
yep.
sure you know, you're taking now a dead end street into a throughway, right. to a degree.
Right.
That would present the opportunity to add some handicap spots,
or at least point to them.
Yeah. At some point, you depending on how many parking spots you add, you're going to have to add parking for handicap parking.
Yeah, that's very close to the fields.
Mm-hmm. Or at least a drop off for folks to walk.
It's just an interesting concept to try to find a way. Our ultimate goal is to try to get everyone that's playing baseball to park in that lot. And I think part of it is, and I can tell you because I've come from all different directions and I know which way people come in. If you are looking for Morton Field and you search it, you end up on Bancroft Ave. You get to the bottom and there's no parking there. You have no place to go. So it doesn't matter which direction. You always funnel into the same dead end.
So we got to change the GPS.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. We're just making
still more with
it. Okay, sorry.
So getting back to some of the things that we're taking as a proactive approach, we've already changed the address on all of our websites for the Burgess Meadow Complex for all the fields. Up until very recently, 245 Bancroft Ave was the address from Morton Field. We've changed that. Because if someone from Wilmington is coming to Reading,
they go
to our website and they look and they say, what GPS coordinates should I put in? So now they're going to put in 62 Open Road. It's going to take them around, hopefully dump them in the parking lot, and they'll walk over. That's
especially with their buses. That's
Yeah, and what we try to do with the buses, the athletic director is pretty proactive with having them drop off, having the bus leave, and then come back. So typically the bus comes back at the end of the game, as I understand it. The recreation is a committee, as I mentioned earlier, is committed to making accommodations for the neighbors based on schedule and trying to keep kind of a open-eyed approach to it. I don't think anyone's just going to say it's going to be 10 o'clock every night or 9 o'clock every night. I think by season it could change. I think certainly, you know, in the fall, things can wrap up at 8 o'clock at night. Instead, you know, sometimes the sun goes down at 4 or 5, it would mean that you could actually use these fields. So I think if you're going to put lights there, it's practical to try to use them, even if it's till 7:30 or 8 o'clock. It doesn't necessarily have to be till 10 o'clock every night. Staff has had a lot of discussion, as I mentioned, about having a one-way going through the bottom of Bancroft. That was what I just described. And I recently talked with our assistant town manager, and she introduced me to the phrase wayfinding signage, which I had no idea what it was about 2 weeks ago. But we've actually done some research on it, and I think that would be a great way to kind of help this situation. It's a proven method of using signage to get people to do kind of what you'd like them to do and kind of follow your rules. So I kind of did some wayfinding. I actually drove the roads and I put up some fake signs on poles to show you what it might look like. And this would be coming down from either Highland or Bancroft, coming off of 129, which a lot of people would come in. Mm-hmm. And that would be a real natural route for people to take that route, coming in even from the other direction, and trying to direct people up Weston and back around. And there would have to be successive signs, but try to get people to get back to Oakland Road and try to divert them from going down Bancroft. Most people will ignore the first sign and maybe see the second sign. So when they get to the corner of Hartshorne and Bancroft, they would now be asked to take a left and not go down there. We could do something where we say tennis parking only. I've put all baseball parking at RMHS Fieldhouse just as a holdover. There's probably a better way to explain that and say that.
A police car right there.
The police car would be good with flashing lights. And then at the base, if they haven't got the message yet, all baseball parking at RMHS Fieldhouse. Actually put the GPS coordinates maybe on the sign. Mentioned no parking on the residential side of Bancroft if they care to park and play tennis. That way people don't overload on either side, and just let people know they would be towed if they do that.
Crush cars down.
This might be a question more for the police in general, but in regards to residents parking in front of their own property, you know, did you kind of address, you know, how do you differentiate between somebody who's...
I think you could do a plaque. You could do a placard. So if Barry was coming over my house and I lived on the street, I could say, Barry, you can park in front of my house. There's a placard put right near.
Yeah,
we have some examples of that. Not a lot in town, where one of the ways they do it is... you have a resident pass, resident sticker. Well, I can't tell you all the secrets, but they do certain things to those stickers to indicate, ha, this is a special circumstance. This is this neighborhood. And then houses get guest passes that they can give out, you know, if they have, so they want to park on the street, they know this one's okay, there's a guest pass. So there's ways.
And here's just the one of the sign. John Carver's another. The Intervale to John Carver's another main route for people to come in. They come right down by P&S. Actually, most people from out of town will do that. This would divert them. Instead of going right, they'd go left around Castine Field, and it would eventually land them into the high school parking lot. So this is just an example of what, this is the best I could find for a sample of wayfinding, but they're attractive signs. Wouldn't be those big blocks I put up. Something a little bit nicer that would kind of give the tone that you're in Reading and not somewhere else. But it would also be attractive enough that, you know, if you had a sign outside your door, you wouldn't so much begrudge, you know, a giant white sign.
These would be permanent, not seasonal, or?
These would be permanent, yeah, they would be permanent. And you could also talk about maybe doing seasonal parking restrictions too. That would be another option.
One of the issues the schools run into, you know, this is good for baseball, but they have year-round activities through the winter included, and they have visiting teams or visiting after-school groups, marching bands or whatever, and they come at the neighborhoods from all sorts of directions.
Tell me about it.
So, yeah. So it would be nice to, and the superintendent knows some of this. He's fully supportive of somehow connecting the baseball field to the high school parking lot. Whether or not we loop around to include, you know, that street right away, you might want to change the behavior first before you create the one way. But he's fully supportive of using the high school parking lot. In all the hours they play, it's not used. You know, high school parking is not used.
The weekends in the spring and summer, there's nobody there.
Right.
So here's a really bad map from Google Earth, but I wanted to use something with the actual tennis courts on it because I actually wanted to show this vacant area over here as another possibility for, if you wanted to try to tuck in some parking, you could certainly do that. But the idea would try to be to facilitate the traffic coming over. So this is just a little bit of an updated map, but Google doesn't allow it to have a flat map, so it looks a little distorted. So just more of an illustration point.
So there would be some trees that would have to get cut down.
Right at the edge.
Talking one lane though, right, Jeff?
Yeah, it would be a single file lane.
Feet, so it would be maybe a doubling of the current.
Yeah, you can actually see on this picture just a little bit better. There's already a walkway there.
Yeah.
So that would just need to be widened. So this would have to be leveled, and there's probably some trees that would have to come down. I wouldn't imagine a lot of them, but just enough to get the traffic through there.
Yeah, I agree. That would be best done in a phase two, if the behavior redirected.
Right. So I think we start today. You know, I think we're already trying to do some of that change behavior parking. But I think that would help some of the other issues that we already have down there. And it was very obvious to me when I drove down there last week that, you know, lights, no lights, we need to fix this problem. So I think I'm committed to it, the Recreation Committee's committed to it, and I know our organizations will be great with it. So with that, I'll take any questions or comments or
any further
hand up the foot candle thing.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? I'm going to just post this real quick. I was going to put this on the presentation, but it did not show well on the computer at all. It was very hard to read because it's an overlay of an overlay of an overlay.
Yeah, why don't you start that out in the audience there?
Sure.
If you're going to put it up.
Sure. Let me just explain what it is real quick. So we actually left out the foot candles for the park because that's sort of understood that it would be bright. And when you see 0.01, that would be a tenth of a foot candle, which is about now, would give you about the same luminescence of what you see out your window right now.
So this is a chart of numbers showing the
it's a chart of numbers.
So you'll see high intensity in some areas and very low.
You see very low intensity. We kind of measured off with the measuring tool around at 200 feet off of the pole is where we start to see 0.00, which is darkness or no light. So if anyone's interested.
John, in regards to that, what kind of tools are available from, what was the name of the company?
Musco.
Lights? Musco.
Yeah, Musco.
What kind of tools are available to show a better display so folks in and around that area could actually see, okay, this is kind of what it's going to look like, you know, from a visual standpoint, rather than just having it on numbers. Do they have any kind of tool that they can
utilize? I asked
the utilize?
Same question. They really didn't. The best thing they can offer is a photometric plan.
Okay.
And that really gives you a sense. What we were trying to do was
because a scientist is sensitive, because me not.
I was trying to actually with one of our engineers figure out exactly how to demonstrate, you know, what 1 foot candle was or what 20 foot candle was. It's very hard because you're talking about light and it has very much to do with what's next to it and what's on the other side of it.
think where Kevin's getting at, though, is it's not so much the mathematics of it, it's
right.
the emotional part of it.
Yeah.
A couple of photographs would go a long way
right.
showing dark, light.
Yeah, yeah, even just simple, you know, bubbles around
right.
where you'd expect that spillage to go out to.
I might be able to give
their
you
website's got tons of stuff.
I would figure they, I would figure they would have come across this bridge before.
Just go to Gene runs into this issue too.
Right.
Yeah. Site development.
If,
right.
Anyone in the audience has a question, I would just ask that you introduce yourself, state your name, address, and you will be memorialized in the sound and video forever. Yes, Mr. Sweeter.
Hi, Dave Sweeter, 90 Hartford Street. So I'm having some difficulty linking plan 2009 First Rental Master Plan.
With this.
In 2009, we had an ad hoc committee which was appointed by the select, and select approved a master plan for the Birch Meadow area. And there's great discrepancies for what was being proposed and what was previously accepted. So I guess that would be the first point of order. The second point of order would be it would appear that we need to do a master plan prior to doing the lighting plan. If you do the lighting first, you get the tail wagging the dog. Call this dog wagging the tail. So I think that's the first step to move forward. We can certainly have a discussion about the lighting and the impact on the neighborhood and the traffic conditions on the neighborhood. But I think the first thing we have to do is a master plan and rethink. So if you can just address how that works with the plan.
Master plan.
Yeah, so I guess where to best start with that, Dave, would be when the first master plan was finished, it's been 6 years. The Board of Selectmen, after about five, asked us to relook at it and asked the Recreation Committee to relook at it. It was obvious to us that we needed more field space, so lighting was the obvious first move for us. Whether these fields are baseball diamonds or football fields, we'd light it the way we're going to light it. I think we're going to put poles there. And I kind of think that was our first step, was to try to have that happen first. We had an opportunity to do it now, and we tried to seize that opportunity. There's other things on that master plan that will change. For instance, Imagination Station, when we talked about it 6 years ago, was a very emotional topic. A lot of people wanted to see Imagination Station come back. I hear very little about Imagination Station now, because we've built 7 playgrounds in neighborhoods since. So I think the need for having something like that has changed. It's the same thing. I think a lot of the needs have changed, and I think that's why we're back doing a survey. We released a survey yesterday around noon for the Birch Meadow Master Plan Survey Committee, or survey. We are currently, when I left my desk at 6 o'clock tonight, we had 252 responses in just a short 2-day span. So there's interest. And we think by the time we close the survey in another 20 days or so, we're going to have close to 300 to 400.
So what did the survey go to?
It went out to the general public. So it was posted on Facebook.
It's a Survey Monkey survey?
Yeah.
It's on the front page of the Tonight's Chronicle. We can probably
I get the Chronicle. I can take a look at it. I just didn't have a chance to read it.
Yeah, it went out. It may take some time to filter through, but it got instant hits. It's social media is pretty amazing.
It was out on Facebook. I know. I saw that.
We posted on Facebook and on Twitter.
Right. Can you address Mr. Sweeter's concerns about the prior plan not meshing with what we're doing now? And what is your timetable for getting an updated plan completed, by the way?
An updated plan we'd like. The survey is the big part of that. We need to compile the results. We're going to take about 30 days to do that, starting yesterday. Once we have that, the committee will continue to meet. The survey that we just released has very much to do with priority and wants and needs of the community. It also addresses parking, traffic flow, so we're trying to take all that into consideration. The plan itself, I don't think, will change wholesale. I think a lot of the plan is good. There's probably 10 to 20% of the plan that may need to be looked at or tweaked, and I think that's what the committee is going to spend most of its time doing. If I had my druthers, I'd be ready for a November town meeting. To be presenting either before the Board of Selectmen or actually at town meeting with the new plan.
And you present the plan, what are we going to present the new master plan?
The new master plan, an updated master plan.
And is there an ad hoc committee that the selectmen have appointed for that?
Well, that's the rec committee that will do that.
Just,
are you recommending that the selectmen appoint an ad hoc committee?
No, they've already done that.
Plan?
They've already done that.
You have, in 2009. In 2009?
Nope, that was appointed in 2009. They built the original plan, that group disbanded.
Yep.
And the Recreation Committee was asked to reevaluate. Instead of the whole committee doing it, they broke into a subcommittee of three, plus myself.
So the Recreation Committee is the one recommending to the selectmen now? Here's a highlight from the 2009 report from the free text comments. Please maintain the natural beauty of Birch Meadow and do not add more parking, lots of buildings. Take special care of the undeveloped meadows and wetlands around this area. Especially here tonight, because they're close to that.
I mean, I think the only new parking that's been suggested is potentially a little bit by the tennis courts that to kind of filter in. I think that the most of the parking is using existing parking and, in fact, protecting homeowners from some of the overflow. So, also there's no development of new fields or taking of undeveloped land to create new fields in what I see here, unless I'm mistaken. So I don't really seeing it diverge that much from what was the original master plan. It just seems more that it's kind of evolving, more than sort of turning on a right angle.
And you shouldn't take my comments as for putting more parking in there as what the Recreation Committee's doing.
Yeah,
it's just my suggestions of looking at it.
From the report.
Yeah.
So the Board of Selectmen, Park Commissioner comments were no tree removal without prior approval, add trees when possible, fences only with this compelling need. If there's a gift that's given to the town, the fence, that it's going to come with future care and maintenance costs, and there's no advertising to be presented. Right, so the selectmen in 2009 took great care to work with the ad hoc committee to come up with some plans that move this project forward. It just seems to me like we need to reinvestigate and assign an ad hoc committee consisting of neighbors and the selectmen and the Recreation Committee in order to review plans that are going forward. So that said, to deal with lights, the lights that are at the tennis courts are 40 feet high, and now you're adding 70 feet high, 30 feet higher than what's at the tennis courts to the baseball diamond. That's a pretty substantial increase in height. The lighting plan that you're seeing is a horizontal foot candle plan, not a vertical foot candle plan. So if you're driving down Main Street in your car at night, what you're seeing are vertical foot candles. Those lights that are in your eyes, we call it glare. That's what the neighbors are gonna face. So the neighbors that are abutting the tennis courts now don't see the horizontals because there's a cutoff. But on the face of their house and out the front of their windows, they're seeing vertical foot candles and glare. So they're looking into the headlights of the lights that are at the tennis courts. So that's a concern. Now, Musco, in fact, is the best lighting manufacturer for sports lighting in the country. And I've used them personally. And they do a good job of it. And they can certainly model for you the vertical and horizontal foot candles. And they can do them against the faces of these houses. Busco Lighting was, at least when I worked on it, the engineer that worked on the Gillette Stadium project. And I worked with them to come up with these kind of details. So we need to do some thinking about how this is going to impact. We need to think about operation and hours of operation. For the last three nights, tonight included, the lights at the tennis courts have burned from 8 o'clock until 10 o'clock. So I'm assuming there's 1,000-watt lights that are each one of those fixtures. So you're burning 24,000 watts per hour to light those tennis courts with no one on them. So if we're going to have that same situation now with a lot more poles and lights, we've got a substantial operating cost.
Do you want to comment on the regulation of the lighting and the billing, how that's...
Yep, sure. Just to address the tennis court lights, it's difficult to kind of play God, if you will, with whether or not the light should be on or not, because I don't live in town.
and they're on a regular schedule, so someone would actually have to shut them off when it's raining. So we've gone with the concept, like tonight, it rained all day, but it may not be raining now. There could be people that want to play. So we've tried to leave them on, because if you start being inconsistent when they're on and not on, I think it creates more problems. The lighting of the other fields are actually would be done by request. So they would only be on when they're going to be used. So if a softball field wasn't being used, they would not be on. They would have to be requested, and they would be set for the days. For instance, the stadium field, we set them Monday through Thursday till 9 o'clock every night. And they go off at 9 every night. If they're not going to use them, I usually get a phone call in the evening and say, we're not using them tonight, can you shut them off, and we'll make that accommodation.
John, is there any way to have an authorized user to be able to turn the lights on and off at the source, as opposed to sort of centrally done? So
not at the source. You can do it by phone, though.
Yeah.
And you can definitely do that. It's whether or not you want to allow it.
Well, I mean, authorized, president of Reading Little League, for example, if they're going to use that field, to know that, okay, the game's rained out, we can turn the lights
you
on.
You could definitely do that. You can give unique, I was just at this website. You can give unique user codes and passwords to access the system, and they can only have certain functionality, so I could actually give Tom usability of just that one field. And he could have, if we wanted to, it would be something the recreation committee would probably want to bet.
This way we're not burning it when we don't need it.
Yeah, no, I'm not an energy waster myself, so.
Gentlemen, next to Mr. Sweeter, did you have your hand up? Somebody back there?
I'll speak, I guess. Jonathan Weber, 84 Hartshorn Street. Just a couple of observations, concerns about what we're talking about. And I want to check with John here on his, just to clarify the parking question over near Rise. You mentioned maybe taking out the volleyball court piece. You weren't talking about the basketball court.
Not the basketball court, no.
Okay.
No, the basketball court.
A couple
fully
people around here said,
yeah,
why are they taking the basketball
court? Fully intend to.
I think the through traffic question is something that's really got to be looked at before you move forward with that. A couple reasons. One, kids moving back and forth. I mean, it's a heavy traffic area for pedestrians. You've got to take that into account.
Right.
Before anything happens there. I think the work you did on the signage in the neighborhoods, other than your graphics, that's something to definitely consider to get people to go to the right place. 62 Oakland Road for the baseball field address, I think will make a big difference.
Yeah.
I can tell you I've seen events down there. Reading Babe Ruth just held their All-Star game.
Mm-hmm.
And they directed people to the high school.
Right.
And if there's a lot less traffic that day than normal and I've seen in the past. I am concerned about the lighting. I think that, to John's point, it can be turned off and on. I know the softball right now, Reading Men's softball, they turn the lights on and off now.
Yep. It's on a one
it's on
switch.
A, it's on one
very
big
easy.
Switch, I think,
yep.
in the house over there.
Yep.
Which is a whole other question that's got to be answered at some point. Why there's a snack shack
with the window
with
facing
the window
third
facing
long,
third
long
base,
story.
And you get killed if you stood in line there. That's kind of a well-designed program.
You're
there.
Not the first person to notice that. I didn't build it.
but I think traffic is a concern. I do have a concern with the tennis only. I think trying to enforce that would be very difficult for police to do.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And I also don't like the fact that you give one group permission to do something that other people in town can't do. So I think what's good for the goose is good for the gander. If somebody gets there early for a baseball game and they get the parking spot, they get the parking spot. If they're not parking over at the high school, which is very easily done. I think that it can be a very walkable complex if we educate people and take it from an education mm-hmm. standpoint of view, drive it forward, get traffic away from the neighbors. Resident parking in front of the houses, I think, is something that should be looked at. Or no parking at all.
Agreed.
On that side of the road. I think from a safety standpoint of view, it's very difficult for somebody to get down there, whether they're playing tennis, playing baseball, playing softball, whatever it may be.
I'm shocked that we haven't done it yet, to be honest. After looking at that, shocked it hasn't been. I'm shocked no one's ever said anything. or brought it forward. If they haven't, we haven't done it in a while.
And I think that that's something to be looked at by the town and police to enforce from the get-go. We just have to change behavior to make this work. As far as the lights go, I think it's workable. You know, with them going off at certain times of the day, not being on all the time, not every night having events, it's something that can be worked with. A lot of us are concerned around the neighborhood because we do see heavy traffic and we do see people, hey, I've got my lawn parked on and I'm not right next door. I'm up around the corner. So I think there's opportunity here to educate people, but I think we also have great parking lots that are not used. We talked about the Imagination Station area. It's kind of sitting there waiting for us to do something with it at this point. And whether it's parking for football games, parking for Coolidge, parking for the Y, it's just an open space. It's a mess at this point. So,
thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I do have a question.
Yes.
My name is Julie Scott, and I live at 129 Yanscom Ave. I'm a direct abutter to Morton Field. And I know that when this was kind of, I got a notice of this in January and I was out of town on vacation, so I'm a little bit, I don't have a lot of information, but I did have a question about Morton Field and the lighting. Currently, right now, I'm the very last house, right there on the cul, that's it, right there,
okay?
Slowly, as I've lived there, field keeps coming closer and closer and closer to my home. Every day, I throw two or three balls out of my yard over. I have dents in my siding. I'm waiting for a window to go, okay? And it's getting worse, okay? So that's really upsetting me. Now I see that there's going to be lights put in there. So what does that mean for me? Well, are you allowing night games? There's games starting at 8 o'clock in the morning. On Sunday mornings where you're like, what is this? You know, it's really not fair, okay? Because you have the tennis courts, you got the lights, you got the guys at night across the other field.
Mm-hmm.
When the lights go out, they're out there partying and, you know what I mean? And it's like, our bedroom is right there. So, you know, I don't know what the plan is as far as the schedule for the games, but now, I mean, they have to leave because it's dusk.
Right.
So I don't know what's the proposal for that. I know lights are, you know, I mean, I understand you want lights, but what does that mean to me? Till 10 o'clock, like across the field?
It hasn't, I don't think it's been completely determined yet, and I think a lot of that will be decided based on the feedback that we get. And I think that's something the Recreation Committee will sit down, and we're going to have successful conversations. So I can't sit here today and say definitely one way or another. I know they're interested in listening and hearing, and if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. I think that's if we can't find some kind of a middle ground, then, you know, I think that's going to be looked at too. So there's no absolutes here.
John, the Sunday morning starts, that's a temporary thing?
Talk
about that?
She said 8 a.m., but we
permanent, not early than
yeah,
that.
We permanent people.
They're in the batting cages over with their metal bats.
Is that what they're supposed to be doing?
That's kind of a hard thing to manage because the fields are closed, but it doesn't stop a handful of people going down and using the public facility. In that instance, you have a couple of options. You could call the cops just on a noise complaint and just ask them to quiet them down. It's very hard to police the general public on something like that. We could put up all the signage we want. We could put out as much education as we want, but people are just going to do what they're going to do sometimes.
Right.
And that's probably an instance that would be best to maybe involve the PD.
Yeah, I know. I mean, why don't they use wood bats?
I hear your concern. I feel very bad.
I understand that there's going to be some dugouts and stuff put in there, which is fine. My other question is, will it be aluminum seating too? Because that's another concern. Because it's somebody like it's always being like.
The clang.
It's like a constant bang.
Yeah. Are you talking about the benches for the benches are actually coated with a plastic.
The new ones.
Yeah, they're it's like a rubber plastic.
Oh, okay, I know what you're
saying. Like a vinyl covering, I guess you'd call it.
That would be helpful.
Yeah, okay.
When are they supposed to be doing all those dug up things, do you know?
I believe they're in progress.
Yeah.
They're in progress.
if they have all their approvals from Concom.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yep.
And then I just had just one other question.
Sure.
Is it a possibility of some kind of netting being put up?
Absolutely.
That is an absolutely reasonable request.
Yeah. I mean, we have a big stockade fence. I'm sure that the people behind me that are
if you want it, we can do it.
You know, I'm getting to that point. Mm-hmm. Okay.
But
I just, you know, depends on how, I don't know what type. Well, we can talk about that separately. But
well, you already have some netting up that you could actually look at, right?
Yeah, we were actually talking about the example of right over the tennis courts. There's netting there. We've extended the poles, and that was to protect the tennis players from the baseballs coming from the upper field.
Mm-hmm.
We could use something simple like that if you wanted to take a look at that and let me talk with your neighbor and let me know if that's something you both agree on, and
okay.
We could possibly consider doing that.
I'm
your neighbor, and you're all for it. That makes it easy.
Okay, right. There you go.
That's
not on the back. So. Yes. Let's take those I haven't spoken yet first. Yes.
Oh, I was just going to say, I'm Justin Lazat, 246 Bancroft.
Okay.
And I'm in favor of some netting.
Okay. Awesome.
He's the other neighbor.
Yes. Do you have another question?
Yeah. No, I was just going to make an observation with the batting cage.
Yeah.
Maybe you put signage on it with hours of usage.
I thought there was already signage on there. Is there not?
I don't think
not
so.
Not that I recall.
I don't think
we could do that. That's a very simple thing
to
do.
Yeah.
I've been woken up on Sunday mornings too at 8 a.m.
You can hear it where you are?
I can hear where I am.
Yeah, okay.
It was actually.
And all it is it's someone down there, it's a private citizen.
Right.
With an aluminum bat.
Yep.
It's not an organized team.
Yep. Right.
It's, I think I know who it is. I won't throw their name off.
That would help. That would actually help the police enforce.
Your son's
enforce
a very good hitter, is what I will tell you.
it would actually help the police enforce it if we have signage. I thought there was already a sign on there. I'll have to go look at that. Thanks, John.
Is there anything we can do in terms of buffering to the extent, to the comment that it's creeping closer and closer? There appears to be a tree line there between the
mm-hmm.
first base side and that kind of cul-de-sac.
Yeah.
Is there a way to build up that buffer with some more?
Maybe some arborvitaes or?
Yeah.
I'm not something green, yeah? Maybe a net behind it.
You probably could, but I think about 5 feet of that land out on the other side of my fence is part of my property.
Okay, gotcha.
So,
on our side, if you wanted to build that up with something,
is
an optical barrier?
There's wetlands back here.
John, I think it's a drainage ditch.
It is.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a drainage ditch.
Is that does that run all the way along
that
the...
That runs all the way along and connects...
I've never noticed where it comes
from
there
down to the river.
Okay.
So put something on the board.
Yeah, so you're somewhat limited, although I'm sure conservation would love some erosion control.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd also like to find out what you could put up. That would be the best sound deafening kind of barrier as well.
I think wooden bats are it.
The Middlesex League actually looked at wooden bats about 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago.
Is that a cost thing?
It was a cost and it was a safety thing.
Really?
Got boarded down, yeah.
Plus performance. The guys like it long enough.
Yeah. Well,
and until you get college to do it.
Yeah, the high school kids
are strong.
You're
not
going
to get high school
to
do it.
Yeah.
Any thoughts to incorporating the tennis court light controls? I know they're on by schedule, but any thoughts about incorporating controls as part of this larger project?
They already have controls. We could...
On the phone?
Yeah, they can be shut off simply. One thing that we could do is have the monitor, because we have a tennis monitor down there Monday through Friday, you know, jump online and turn them off if it's going to be wet. But on a night like tonight, we don't send a monitor down. So it's kind of, are you going to send the monitor down just to declare the courts closed or open? I think that's what makes it difficult.
But I think you can probably do the same system that you do the sprinklers.
With the
fact, you're turning the sprinklers off when it rains these days.
Right. It's just a very simple.
You can see what happens.
A rain?
It's a water sensor. But
yeah, a water sensor.
There are
right.
a lot of nights that when it's nice in the summer, that the courts are not being used, that the lights are blaring. And I don't know what the arrangement was with the switching and controlling of the courts, whether they're able to be controlled individually, whether they're able to be controlled in sets of two.
They can be done in twos.
So there's some logic there that needs to have some control sequence looked at. If you're going to do the entire complex, there's going to be a greater control. And I can tell you they're not going to bring it from the box by the tennis courts all the way over the other side unless you have a lot of money to spend to cop the cable.
Yeah, the question I'd have in regards to that, and maybe one of the residents could answer it, you know, to me a constant is something that's easy to take out of your mind. Something that's going to continue to go on and off like a light switch might be something that's actually more intrusive.
In other words, if it's off at this point, but now it's no longer raining and someone wants to use it, and then they go on, and then they go off again, and then they go on. You know, my question would only be for those residents, which is more intrusive?
I guess that would be an environmental issue.
It's pretty bright.
If you want to do...
Okay, so you don't mind the on, wouldn't mind the on and off as much as the constant? Okay.
I would welcome the on and off.
Okay.
Especially when you add lights from the field. I mean, I could mow my grass on the spillage from the courts.
It's not the spillage.
It's not the spillage.
So that's what I was trying to say. When you're looking down, if you can throw up that slide of
sure.
the lights, looking down. So what you're seeing in those photographs are horizontal foot candles. So you're in a plane in a bird's eye view looking down, and that's what you're seeing.
Mm-hmm.
The spillage is the lights that falls behind the light. Now, the problem in the neighborhood is the vertical foot candles, which would be measured on the face of a building.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So it's necessary to have vertical and horizontal. Without that, you wouldn't see the ball rotating. You wouldn't be able to play the sport. So
right.
you need
okay.
to have vertical
right.
and you need to have horizontal. The problem is the vertical is a component that looks like glare. It looks like a headlight that comes at you. So if you go in the houses that are on Bancroft Street and you look out their windows, what they're seeing are headlights, which are the lights from the court. They're doing a very good job of horizontal lighting, but they're not capable of doing anything but the vertical component. So when we look out, that's what we see. It's just like a car driving down the street, same face.
Okay.
So that's, and Musco can model that. It's not a problem for them to model that. And I think they should. And as a product of this, I think we certainly want to have them model it. They're the best. They're also the most expensive. But I wouldn't want anybody else in my field. Right?
Okay.
So can I ask a question?
Sure.
I know town meeting has moved $1.5 million or whatever the cost was that they moved.
$1 million.
$1 million, and the other $500,000 came from the library project?
It's only $1 million total for this.
This million solid?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I know it's changed a lot. But what's the life expectancy of this? What's the life cycle cost? Who's paying for the usage of this and the capital improvements? Is this all part of the users that are paying this, or is this the taxpayers of Reading that are forwarding this money?
You talk about
who's going to maintain it?
Part?
Yeah, so for the operational part, the users that actually flick on the lights, as you know, Dave, with Musco, you can actually go in and assign cost centers. So if Reading United Soccer uses the field, I can actually assign that night to them. So they would actually pay that bill. I'll let Bob talk a little bit more about the capital and the debt service that would be paid on it.
Yeah, right now we've talked a lot to the DOR, the Massachusetts Department of Revenue. Recreation charges fees for all their activities. The lighting fee is an easy thing to do. You use the lights, you pay the fee. That's simple. What about the cost of using the field? You know, we had a discussion earlier. You saw some of that if you were here earlier about how do you allocate costs. Right now, it's fair to say that the recreation fees are below their costs. They could take in more revenues if they chose to set fees higher and people would pay them. It would be a simple matter to say that you can raise your fees X in order to make more money to pay the costs you're already incurring that you aren't incurring. Because there is that gap, if you will, fees can be raised if the recreation committee chooses to and people choose to pay them in order to pay the debt service of all of this, for instance. If the recreation committee's fees currently were paying all the costs, they would not be allowed to raise them further to pay for that debt service. So it's a kind of complicated answer, but given the facts we have right now, it's quite possible that recreation fees could pay all of this. But on an ongoing basis, 10 or 20 years from now, when we have to replace these again, I'd say that's on the taxpayer, whatever the life expectancy would be of this technology.
And
these
we're getting
lights.
30-year warranty?
The life expectancy is actually 25 years. They actually warranty the product for 25 years. That means if a light goes out, we don't even have to call. They tell us that they're dispatching someone to replace a bulb. I had someone from Musco call me about 3 months ago and say, we're replacing a fuse for you. We noticed the fuse is out. And it's I haven't had to pay a nickel towards the light. So their package is true and through. And the other question I asked was about the LED question. I said, we're not doing LED this time around, but what if the technology's there, and I'm assuming it will be when the life expectancy is up, can it be retrofitted? And they were pretty positive that it could be. So the poles would stay and the lights would just, the fixtures would change. So
we're proposing metal halide now?
Metal halide, yeah.
As opposed to LED, so that's all.
We they kicked it around pretty well.
What's the difference in the cost?
The difference in the cost was half to three quarters.
Oh, nine?
Yeah.
You don't get the same quality of lighting. With
yeah, that was the problem.
Well, that's changing with time, but I
think it is.
Right. Not this year.
And the remainder of the maintenance? Remainder of the maintenance on the fields? Is that comes out of capital? Yeah. Is that what's happening?
Of
for instance, the fences that are in disrepair and the screens that are in disrepair, is that part of the operational budget, capital budget?
It is when there's a need. That's put in the budget. It's not a lot of money. The organizations themselves pay what I would call maintenance, so to take care of the field, to fix the pitcher's mound, to rake the infield and all that, they pay for all that, or they physically go out and do it. But if you wanted to, for instance, replace an outfield fence, John Fido has an annual playground program, which every year there's $25,000 to $50,000 put in towards playgrounds and things like fields. So yeah, that is part of the taxpayers' money, if you will. Whether it replaces, you know, swings and slides on a playground or an outfield fence, it's on a recurring basis.
Yeah, to be perfectly honest, we've been very fortunate to have organizations that have stepped up to repair things, because we would never, our fields wouldn't look the way they did if we didn't have people willing to do what they've raised $50,000 to $100,000 over the last 4 or 5 years just to do the work that they've done. They have companies come in and edge and do field cleanups for us every year.
Yeah, the Morton Field work that you'll soon see. Town meeting approved the funding, understanding that there was a promise that it would probably be privately raised. The last number I heard, it was 80% raised.
That was close.
And that's a month ago.
Jeez, they're out there all the time. It's like
those guys work hard.
It's like Fenway Park.
Those guys
every
work real hard.
Every single day,
yep.
There's
they
somebody
really
there
hard.
Doing something
yep.
every day.
They take a lot of pride in it. And it's the same thing throughout. Our Little League managers do the same thing. They're out there every day trying to get these fields ready and get them safe and make sure they're playable for kids. So we're very lucky in Reading, I have to say.
We certainly are. So are the kids.
I'm a hockey player, so I don't know. I'm going to play baseball.
So let me ask just one more thing, and then I'll stop it. The basketball courts, originally they were appropriated to be done this year. The lights, the courts, that whole area seems to be now on the very back burner.
Yeah, you get a better memory than I do.
I remember that.
Yeah,
that was probably part of the whole
perhaps,
project.
Yeah.
Well, I just remember looking at it because I was going to take it on as a personal project, but you guys seem to have it under control, so when I ask questions.
Yeah.
And so I backed off, but you seem to have it.
Seems
like now it's gone completely off.
No, it's not completely off. I would say that I honestly think the way the master plan shakes out, if that's something that people come back and that's an overriding need and want, I think it could very easily slide up as a priority. It's not an expensive project, that's the thing. It doesn't have to be a $200,000 basketball court. We just did one at Washington Park, very inexpensively, so.
We wanted to look like the tennis courts. Okay.
Yes, right. We'd like to look
like. John, just at a minimum, that the chain link fence needs to be fixed down at the basketball court too. I mean, it's a dangerous situation at this point.
Would be cutting holes.
Big hole on the side of it. That's all.
Okay.
For your knowledge, as part of the annual budget and 10-year capital plan, there is another $1.5 million set aside, if you will, for Birch Meadow as an area in addition to this million. Maybe that's what the $1.5 million that was mentioned earlier. And that's contingent on what the Recreation Committee learns through their survey and suggests as additional improvements. So there's money already earmarked for this. We just don't know what the this is exactly.
Yes.
Part of the making the Bancroft a through street for game day, I think we need a speed bump right at the end where Hartshorne intersects. You get that top lot right there. You know, that's an accident waiting to happen.
Yeah. That's a tough corner to see.
It's a tough corner, and you have college-age kids, high school kids, they come flying down over the weekends.
Yeah.
They don't.
Interesting, when we rebuilt that,
the
entrance to that playground used to be right on the road. We shifted it to the side when we rebuilt it for that same reason. There's accident waiting to happen.
You know what the other problem part of it is that I see? I mean, I'm on Hanscom, but there aren't any sidewalks. It's just you walk in the parking lot, you walk on the grass, or you walk on the, you know, the residents' grass.
Yeah.
Even on Hartshorn, there's only one, one side of the road has a sidewalk. From the top park all the way up, there's no sidewalk.
Yeah.
Mm. People walking on the streets. And, you know, since I've lived there almost 30 years, there's been a lot more children moving into the neighborhood. And even when I go down the street, you know, these little kids are running around. There's no place. And I know this isn't for you guys, but it's also something that when you're doing the traffic study, you might want to kind of consider about sidewalks for the children.
You have to get the children and then walk on the sidewalks, though.
And, sorry, my other concern is just trees. More trees.
Okay.
All kinds of trees.
All right, do we have more?
Yes, sir.
I have one question. Mark Farrar, 77 Hanscom Avenue. Is the goal of this expanded hours to better serve existing customers, or is it to market the fields to more organizations and bring in more and different types of organizations? I'm sort of new to the town, so I'm not sure who all the users are. Are they mostly youth groups?
Yeah,
you talked about people hanging out after games.
That's a great question. No, it's for existing for sure. We don't have, if you're new, you probably haven't heard me say over the last 12 years that we're out of field space. Mm-hmm. So everything we do is to try to increase space for our in-town groups. It's our number one priority.
Okay.
So yeah, that would be our number one goal.
Okay, and it's the towns aren't used for, you know, rented out for out-of-town?
They can be. That would be a Recreation Committee decision of whether or not they wanted to continue to allow any of these fields to be rented, because currently they can be. But we don't have lights on them now. So there will be a whole set of policy making and fee structure setting by the Recreation Committee.
You might want to describe how tennis works in that regard with the two sets of fees in and out of town.
Oh, okay, yeah. Bob just mentioned, we do have, we sell a tennis pass for the tennis courts, and we do have an in-town pass and an out-of-town pass. The in-town pass is $20. The out-of-town pass is $120. We don't make it $120 because we're trying to make money. We try to make it $120 to discourage people from coming from out of town. We really don't want people from out of town. And quite honestly, that's why we have tennis monitors. It's not to monitor the Reading people. It's to monitor people that aren't from Reading that are creating the issue. So it's kind of the same kind of concept. Is my preference is never to rent to out-of-town people. Do I have space sometimes to rent to them? Sure. Is it nice to make a little extra money? Sure, but I don't bend over backwards by any stretch, because the money isn't worth the headaches that come along with it, to be perfectly honest.
Any final questions from the board? John, you want to comment on next steps and maybe the timetable for the Rec Committee's future work?
Yeah, I think what I'd like to see happen is the Recreation Committee to maybe hold an official public hearing at some point. I don't know if that's going to be the second and final step, but we need to probably have that happen pretty quickly, so they can make a final decision. I'd like to be able to bring a final decision back to the Board of Selectmen based on fees. It's hard to do anything without pencil and paper. Until we do the borings, we really don't know. And we haven't put it out to bid, so we don't even know if we can afford the whole project. And we won't know until they dig down. If they're going down, they have to dig down 100 feet to put poles, and it's going to be far more expensive than it would be to dig down, you know, 40 feet in refusal. So we won't know until the borings are done and we actually have some design done of whether or not we can afford the whole project.
Also, given that an ad hoc committee was used the first time we did a master plan, I would like both boards to take that under consideration, whether or not the practice should continue. Bob?
My understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, especially for Rich, the existing master plan is the default. Recreation Committee is making suggestions of changes to that plan. So if something is mentioned in the master plan, it's not like it disappears. Unless they say, you know, we don't like this section of the old master plan, it should go away.
Right.
So the work of the ad hoc committee is not disappearing, if you will.
I'm just trying to look for a way to get neighborhood involvement in here.
I think this is the best way, but again, we noticed 120 people.
Yeah.
This is a good turnout, but it's not 120 people.
It's an informed turnout.
So, you know, if you could spread the word to your neighbors.
Is there any way that you give a better note, like a longer notice?
Yeah.
I mean, I think this is just.
When the recreation committee holds one, sure.
Yeah, we'll do.
Yeah, because it's just, it was like a 3 or 4 day notice that we got, I got this, so.
Yeah.
More notice would be great.
Yeah, yeah, when they have a formal hearing, they'll give you at least 2 weeks.
And John, when you do come back, it would probably be good to have the results of the, survey sort of tabulated and kind of presented so that, you know, folks basically who are, you know, weighing in and voting, they're not necessarily gonna be here at the meeting, but it would be good to kind of have that.
Yeah, I resisted looking at them, but it's, there's a lot, and there's a lot of great feedback in there, so that will prove to be very helpful.
It's probably good to keep it quiet till it's done.
Exactly.
Is the link on the town website as well?
The link should be on the readingrec.com website. Easily accessible, it's on.
Should probably put it on the homepage.
I gave it to Matt, I'm assuming Matt will put it on very well.
Yeah, it might already be there.
Our administrative services director actually put it out as a press release too, and it got on a couple of listservs too, so it's gotten a lot of view, I was.
Two days.
It was released at noon, and within 45 minutes, I had 52 responses, so it was incredible.
Just a question on that, I opened it up, but I haven't taken it yet, is it, I'm assuming it's one person, one vote, not like American Idol, you can vote 10 times?
It's one per PC. It's one per IP address.
Alright, well, that's, so you have to.
Yep.
You have to.
Build consensus.
You have to really.
If you wanna vote twice, you'll have to go to the library.
Alright, Al. Yeah, final one.
Is it fair to say that the public hearing will have the foot candle levels and the hours of operation? Is it fair enough to say?
Rich, what do you think? Do you think we can have that done? We're actually meeting next Tuesday night, and that could be a lot of the conversation Tuesday.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how you'd have a public hearing without that information, because that's what impacts the neighbors.
Yeah, the fees shouldn't so much, but the foot candles for sure, and the overlays. Unfortunately, we're trying to overlay our own material with Musco's material.
Well, I think
in a perfect world, we'd have them do everything.
Musco is going to be your source for that. You have to pay for it.
Right.
But they have the technology, they have the manufacturers.
Yep. And we'll ask about the vertical spillage too.
Yeah, it's not going anywhere without the vertical.
Yep.
Could you incorporate, you know, a diagram of what it would look like with more and the tennis courts on at the same time?
On at the same time?
Sure.
I can find, I'm sure they can,
which it will be inevitably at some point.
Yep, most definitely. Most definitely.
All right, I want to thank everybody. Very informative session for all of us. We should go into executive session.
Any minutes or not?
We don't have no minutes. We don't have to do anything with the livery license, correct?
Bob, the livery license.
Do we have anything with the livery? That's something you
take
care of.
No, you don't need to know. That's, it's
right?
All set.
Yes. Okay. Move that the Board of Selectmen go into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, and that the Chair declares that an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining position of the body and not come back into open session.
The Chair so does declare. Is that seconded? We'll call the Board as a roll call vote. John?
Yes.
Yes, Dan?
Kevin? Yes.
Eric? Yes.
4-0, we are now adjourned.